Hello there.
Hello, this is Emily Swallow. And you're listening to the Mandalore podcast with Cyber Wren and D. Vizsla. This is the way.
Padawan.
I'm Ahsoka. Master Yoda sent me.
Warrior.
No one has her kind of determination.
Loyal friend.
They may be willing to die, but I am not the one who is going to kill them.
Outcast.
The moment there were any suspicions about her loyalty, the Council turned their back on her.
Rebel.
I am no Jedi.
Join Cyber Wren and D. Vizsla as they follow the epic continuation of Ahsoka's story.
I know you can do this, Ahsoka.
And witness the search for her lost friend Ezra and her mortal enemy, Grand Admiral Thrawn. This is the Mandalore Podcast, and this is Star Wars Ahsoka.
Yes, this is the way. Welcome to the Mandalore, the definitive podcast for Star Wars on Disney Plus, and it is time for Ahsoka to make her live-action solo show debut, and holy nerf herders, are we excited about this one. We've got the first two episodes to discuss here tonight, and we're doing them both as one full-length show, so buckle up and get ready for the next 7 weeks of listening to us about Ahsoka. I'm trying to catch up to my sister before she leaves for another galaxy. I am Cyber Wren.
And I am D. Vizsla.
Yes, man. So, part one, Master and Apprentice. Part two, Toil and Trouble. Holy crap. Can you describe it in a couple words, your feelings right now for Ahsoka?
Oh, wow. Long, how do I say this? Probably most anticipated.
Yeah, that's a good one. That is a good way to put it.
That's a couple words, yeah.
Well, we are here on the Mandalore podcast. We've been podcasting on Star Wars Disney Plus shows for a couple of years now. But if you're only listening, there is a new video companion to the show. We are staring at the cameras as we speak for our new YouTube channel, and we're trying to bring the show onto YouTube and see if we can get some viewership happening there, so you guys can see what we look like. You can see our beautiful Star Wars backgrounds, and so if you're a listener and you want to check out the show, what it looks like, then hop on over to YouTube and check out the Mandalore podcast. You'll find us there.
Nice.
New and improved. We're growing. That means we're learning and growing.
That's right. That's right.
But you've been doing this for a long time. You're more used to being on camera than me.
Yeah. It's a couple years.
Well, let's get into it. Do we have any news? We got some news to talk about?
Just a little bit.
All right, let's do a little bit of news. What's going on out there?
Well, I'll do the second one first because it's more Mandalorian, but people have been asking for this. Apparently, the Mandalorian seasons 1 and 2 are actually coming out on Blu-ray here soon.
Get out of here. Really?
Yes.
So actual physical media.
Physical wow. media, which a lot of people apparently have been screaming about. And I'm actually very surprised that Disney's doing this.
Because nothing's coming out on disc anymore. Like, it's rare.
I mean, I don't know why you would. You want them to pay to go to the streaming service, I would assume. But because you're losing numbers there a little bit. So maybe they think they can make money off of this. I don't know. But
well, I mean, most people that are watching it are watching it on Disney Plus. Maybe this is more for the collectors that love the show so much they want a hard copy of it. And as we know, with a lot of Blu-rays, they have all the behind-the-scenes bonus features and stuff. Maybe they'll release some extra stuff there we haven't seen yet, and that'll entice more sales.
Maybe. Yeah. But probably, I mean, Disney Plus, you know, the bonus features are the ones that they had, too, are on there as well, so most of the time. Hmm. So, I don't know. Yeah, it could be some extra stuff. But I haven't dived too deep into it to see what's on it. But
yeah,
all it is that season 1 and 2. And I believe Book of Boba Fett also was announced that it's coming out. So
are you going to buy them?
No, I'm probably not. I haven't bought a Blu-ray, and I don't even know when. I did collect, I think the last ones I bought were I collected all of the Infinity Saga of Marvel. Like all those movies.
Yep. Yeah, I got all of those too.
But
yeah.
After Far From Home, Spider-Man Far From Home, I stopped buying those. Mm. And I don't even know if those got released. I guess they did. I don't even know anymore.
They're still releasing them because when I go into Walmart, I walk by the electronics section and they always have that one Blu-ray rack out in front and it's got all the new releases on one side. So I always check them out. Oh, that's out. Okay, cool. And I know I go home to see if I can find them at home.
Ah, okay. Yeah. Yeah. I rarely, I go to Best Buy. Do you guys got Best Buys up there?
Yep.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. But our Best Buy is like, there's hardly any physical media in there anymore.
Wow.
It's all computers and TVs.
Yeah. But imagine this, though. What if some weird future bug happens and it shuts down all the online stuff? You don't have access to your downloadable media anymore. You're going to have your physical media to keep enjoying. Like, never know, right?
I won't be able to watch it then.
Yeah. Yeah. So it's just that feeling of having it in your hands, I guess some people enjoy. I mean, maybe they'll release, maybe they'll get a nice colorful picture book with it or, you know, something to make it worthwhile.
Yeah, artwork, you know, it's like a comic book. Yeah. I mean, people do collect the artwork that comes with, so I get that.
Yeah. Cool.
So anyway, there's that. And then the other thing is I thought it'd be just a neat little mention on here because I'm going to probably talk a lot about it on Inside the Forest, but StarWars.com, I noticed it a few days ago and then I'm just now seeing articles on it. But on StarWars.com, when you go to, you know, films and series, the tabs they have where you can find all the content.
Right.
Now, each movie or each series that you go into, they are designating the era on it now. And if you click on that, like, for example, Ahsoka, it'll say New Republic era. And you can click on it. And when you click on it, it takes you to a page, which is simply StarWars.com/eras. And it lays out all the content that is part. It's all, you know, the live action stuff and the animated. It's the TV shows and the movies. But it labels. Actually, the games are on there too. It puts in the titles and logos of the show/content under the eras that they are. So they are really, you know, really full force into this era thing. Obviously, Dawn of the Jedi and the New Jedi Order don't have anything underneath there, but everything else technically does. Wow. So it's pretty neat.
That is totally neat. It's also really helpful because a lot of this stuff is confusing. What fits into what timeline and where, because some of them are so close to the transition of timelines, you're not sure which one it might belong to. So that's actually really cool.
Yeah, really neat. Really neat. Yeah. So now
maybe we should post a link on their Facebook page, maybe, so people can just go right to it. Yeah.
And what's pretty neat. The only thing that I was really interesting was that, again, all of the eras have something in them. Technically, New Jedi Order doesn't have anything, text or logos. Dawn of the Jedi, nothing. But the Old Republic era, it doesn't have any logos, but it does have text. And it says, the Republic is founded among the worlds of the Galactic Core, and the Jedi Order emerges to protect it. A schism within the Jedi leads to the creation of the Sith in this epic era. Ooh. So that's all it says. There's no logos, obviously, because they haven't associated any games to this. Or that.
Yeah, yeah.
But I'm pretty much going to guarantee that the Old Republic game that they're remaking, in a sense, is going to fall right in there.
Gotcha.
And they're going to show this description, really, of the birth of the Sith and stuff like that. So,
yeah, yeah.
But anyway, all the logos are there. It's pretty neat.
That is pretty cool. I will have to check that out after we're done here. That's cool. Yeah, it's just really helpful. And I actually like this. I'm a guy that's very organized. I like to have things easy to find and organized in certain ways. So the fact that Star Wars is doing this, I appreciate it.
I do too.
Yeah. That is really cool. Cool.
So other than that, you know, the strikes are still going on, so they're really not talking about anything.
And that's why news is pretty at an all-time low. Like, they're just, since the last time we recorded was talking about the trailers for Ahsoka, there still wasn't much news out then, so...
No.
Yeah, man. Not a lot, but We'll have to see as things are going on with Ahsoka. We'll keep track of, maybe we can keep track of your numbers and stuff like that, and we can just report on that kind of stuff.
Right, right.
How well it's doing, but yeah. Cool. Well, the only other thing we can say, which is standard on the show, is to help spread the word by talking about our show. Get your friends and family, coworkers to listen to us. That's what helps us the most. And then you can also support the show by going to patreon.com/themandalorepodcast, and you can support us with your hard-earned Star Wars credits or dollars or whatever you got on you. Send us gems and jewelry, that works too. Send us a lightsaber, I wouldn't mind. That'd be a great way to say thanks, but you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, so there you go. Let's get into our ratings and impressions for the show.
You'll find I have many qualities for you to dislike.
All right, so we're going to do this both episodes in one. I decided, I was watching and I thought, okay, it's two episodes, let's break it down and we'll do one episode and cover the second episode. And then as I was watching them both and taking my notes, I was like, nah, you know what? This really is like an epic-long movie just with a credit break in the middle. Let's combine it and make it one. So we're going to rate it as one overall episode. And for those of you that are new, if you're just discovering us on YouTube and stuff, I really suggest checking out some of our older episodes if you want to check out our Obi-Wan coverage or Bad Batch coverage. We've covered everything on Disney Plus. But we basically start with an overall impression and rating, and then we get into what we call Cantina Chatter, and that's where we talk about the cool stuff, just the wow moments and stuff that make us Star Wars fans nerd out and get excited about. Then we do favorite scenes, where we play actual clips from the episode, and then we end it with a big, deeper discussion section called The Bounties, and that's where we get into the thick of things, and I ask Fizzla a lot of hard questions that hopefully he finds answers for, because he's really good at that kind of stuff. He's got the knowledge. And then we do feedback after that. Feedback is where our fans send us in emails and voicemails, and we listen to them all, read them all, and we respond to all of them. So unless you guys are like being really rude and crude and it's not stuff we want part of our show, then we'll edit all that out. But we do make sure to answer everybody. So let's get to our ratings and reviews. So I am giving this one a 10 epically beautiful stories we have yet to witness. Now, I asked you at the top of the show if you could describe it in a couple words. My two words is epically beautiful. That's how I describe Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. I'm not a Mandalorian, a few words. My name is Cyber Ren, and most Mandalorians stay quiet. They don't say much. They say one or two word responses, but you guys know me. I'm the one who speaks, and I actually can't find the words to fully express how stunning this premiere was in every way. Dave Filoni poured his heart into this one with every ounce of passion and love for this character that he could muster. And what it gave us was this TV show on a grand scale like we've never seen. I was just comparing it to all the other ones. I mean, even up against The Mandalorian, there was something about the feeling with Ahsoka. Every moment, every visual, every musical cue, it felt like a cinematic event. And it was just awesome. I can't wait to see where this goes. I can't wait to get to witness a story from a time that we know nothing about. It's going to be a fun ride. I cannot see them losing any ground on this one at all. I don't think there's going to be one of those episodes where we go, filler episode, wish they didn't do it. I think it's going to be 8 episodes of pure joy.
Nice. I'm going to go... I'm actually going to go 9.
Okay.
90 minutes of pure joy.
Gotcha.
This was easily the most anticipated show for me. I really was looking forward to Obi-Wan, of course, and the return of Hayden Christensen and all that, but to see a show about Ahsoka and brought to life by one of the people that obviously created her, it's just incredible to see this journey. In 15 years... Her anniversary was actually 15 years this month.
Wow.
Of when we debuted the character of Ahsoka. And you're right, it was absolutely beautiful to see. The shots were thoughtfully framed. The colors were just stunning. Tone was great. Very Star Wars. And it doesn't surprise us because Filoni gets it. There's no doubts there. He is the embodiment of George Lucas now, as he carries on this next saga of content.
master and apprentice, right?
Absolutely. That's very well said. Absolutely. The only thing that kept me from giving this a 10 is, to be honest, it didn't really show me or tell me anything I didn't already know. Because everything that I think we knew going into it, from the characters to where we're going, there was nothing that really surprised me fully about this episode. And I'm sure we'll get into it. But either way, still really, really loved it and look forward to the rest of the season.
Nice. I like it. Yeah. I mean, it can only go up from there, right?
It can. I'm pretty sure there will be 10s coming from you. Yeah. I'm pretty sure.
This coming from the guy that gave all of Obi-Wan a 10, 10, 10, 10. Yeah, there's got to be 10s coming in Ahsoka.
Did I give every episode a 10 in that?
Almost, I think. See. I got,
oh, actually, I did do 10s all the way.
Yeah.
You're right.
All right, well, let's get into our Cantina Chatter, the section where we like to talk about all the cool stuff that just was like, whoa, that's awesome. Let's do Cantina Chatter.
If you have trained her well, she shall take care of herself.
Well, I always like to start it off exactly where our show starts off, and that's talking about what we get in the opening shots, because Star Wars is known for giving us something in the opening shot. They give you that wow factor, that wow moment that you just... Most of the time, especially in the movies, you get this breathtaking scene. And I think Ahsoka brought that back. Now, before we get to it, I'm going to go through the steps of it. And the very first thing I notice is the opening graphics. You know, when you first press play and it goes through that little Disney kind of music. And you always, every show has all the helmets or the heads of many of the characters that are within the show. Or part of Star Wars, they flash by, and I was watching this one as I do, and they've put all the new heads and helmets in here. So I saw Chopper, I saw He Yang, is that how you say it? He Young?
Hugh Yang.
Hugh Yang. It seemed like every character was pronouncing it differently in the show.
Hugh Yang.
And we saw an Inquisitor, and we saw one of those Guardian droids, which I'm calling them right now, quote unquote Guardian droids. So there already was 4 new helmets in that opening shot. I thought, cool.
Yes. Okay. And interesting enough, they usually flip between blue and red.
Okay, yeah.
But this time it was all red.
They're all red. Wow, I didn't even notice that.
Yeah. Crazy. And Hannah pointed that out to me.
Yeah?
Yeah. Because normally it kind of signified like blue ones were good guys and red ones were bad guys.
Yeah.
But sometimes they were a little off because like the Mandalorian, I think, was red a couple times. But these, they're all red.
All red. Well, that's going to tie into my next 2 points about the opening, because there might be something happening here. So the next thing is the opening music. The very first few notes, very primal, very jungle life type of vibe. And it kind of made me think of Tales of the Jedi, where we see Ahsoka come from her home planet, full of life and jungle. They live in the trees and all that kind of stuff. Like it just had that note to it. But then it quickly transitions into a very foreboding, threatening type of feel, and just instantly put you on edge, like something is coming and it isn't good.
Right. Yeah. No, it was very interesting.
Yeah.
Very different, too. It was very good.
Something different, which is cool, because, you know, depending on the show, some of the music has felt, we've heard this all before, but, you know, with Mandalorian, that was something brand new, so I think Ahsoka's doing that again. Now, before I move on to the next point, I do want to talk about the entire soundtrack for the show here. It was so beautiful, so magical, so mesmerizing. They found the right mix to not only make this soundtrack stand out, but also be a little bit different, but still feel Star Wars at the same time, which I think is what you were just kind of touching on.
Yes. Yeah. Totally
felt... Man, it was beautiful.
Totally felt Star Wars, but totally felt different. You know, really thought out.
Yeah. Did you notice... I saw somebody say this online, apparently, and you can maybe corroborate it or not for me. The ending theme during the end credits is a mix of Ahsoka, Hera, and Sabine's personal themes, kind of mixed together to make one big song. Did you pay attention to it?
I didn't. I'd have to go back and really focus on each one of their themes, because I don't know if I really can recognize fully their themes separately, because there was a lot of, you know, you can tell there were a lot of the kind of what they call the binary sunset, the Jedi theme song kind of interwoven between Ahsoka and Sabine, the different scenes that they had. So
yeah.
So yeah, I'm interested in getting the soundtrack and kind of hearing their themes individually.
I did like that ending theme. We'll talk about that again in a little while, but I did like the ending theme while we were seeing the credits and the map that was drawing. It was just beautiful music, just all of it. Mm-hmm. But let's get back to the point about the opening of this entire show. We get the opening story scrawl. And I'm pretty sure, is this the first time one of the Disney Plus TV shows gets the traditional opening story scrawl across the screen? I don't think any of the other shows have done that, have they?
No, they haven't done that.
So this...
I don't think so. I think Andor, if I believe... No, I think it was Obi-Wan that had just some words pop up or something.
Yeah, I don't think we got the scroll. But you're sitting in the big movie theater
right. Watching
the next movie. That's what I think. So not only that, but we also get the big spaceship crawl across the screen as well, which is like a Star Wars staple to open every major movie.
Yeah, it basically was... Basically was the crawl. I mean, I think
totally was.
I talked about this. I mentioned that I kind of feel like if you were gonna do it like this, might as well have done it the traditional way. Maybe not with the big Star Wars music in the logo, but why not have it, you know, kind of angled like you do,
like it's going off like into the distance.
Yeah, like it's going to the distance, like it's part of the galaxy. Yeah. I would have been for that. Maybe Filoni thought about doing that. He didn't want to make it seem like it was part of the movies or whatnot, but it was an opening crawl, and you probably should have just did it that way. I don't know.
Yeah. Still, though, again, it's a step. I mean, we haven't gotten this on the TV show. I just thought all of these things just made it feel like a movie, and I'll come back around to that. But the last point I had about the opening crawl, touching back on what you were saying with all the helmets being red, the lettering was also red, and I can't remember if that's the first time we've ever had the lettering in red. It's always been yellow.
Yeah, the lettering has been yellow on the crawls now.
On the crawls.
The words that pop up when it's just words, like in Solo, there were words that started that. Those were blue. Mm-hmm. You know, just like the end credit kind of color.
Yeah, yeah.
But no, this is the first time we've seen red lettering like that. Yeah.
And I don't know what it did for you, but right away, it just, all I could think of was, oh my God, the Sith. Like, red lettering, the Sith.
Yeah.
Because it gives that feeling of evil, that there's a darkness coming, and the music that they had playing during the opening scrawl is like nothing felt good and happy about this opening. It just felt like, oh crap, we're going to be in trouble.
Yeah. Well, and it gets into that too from the beginning, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess you didn't mention it too, but the Lucasfilm logo, I believe, was red. You normally it's like a metallic,
you're right.
Gray. I think it was like a reddish color too. So everything's red right now.
Yeah, I feel like did we maybe watch Star Wars Acolyte instead? Like that's what I felt for that show.
So maybe the sabers, which I don't know if we're going to get into the sabers. Maybe the sabers aren't orange. Maybe they are red, actually.
No, they're for sure orange. I do bring it up when we meet the
one
new
character. They are. It is different, though, from the trailer, because I did a side-by-side, and the sabers are different from the trailer than they are in the show.
In their color?
I think they're off, but the blade in the trailers, remember we talked about how it doesn't have a white blade? It does in the show. They're finally white.
Maybe that was the final touch-up then.
Yeah, I think there were changes. They weren't fully done with the effects in the trailer. So,
okay. Well, you can bring that up when I talk about I bring up the new character and talk about his saber. So, let's get everyone on the same page right off the bat. When does this take place? Everybody is, I think, confused still about the timeline. You know, we got a few words of dialogue in here where we heard a couple of characters say, it's been years since I saw her, or it's been years since we were at that place, or whatever. So starting from when Rebels ended, because this traditionally, everyone's been saying this is season 5 of Rebels, and even Dave Filoni went on record saying, yeah, it is season 5 of Rebels. So from the point of when Rebels ended, remind us of that, to where we are now. Where is this timeline? Everything that we saw in these first two episodes, is it all the same timeline, or do we do any time jumping in here?
Okay, so this take a breath, because this is a little, this could be confusing. And honestly, there's still a lot of question marks to me in the timeline.
Okay.
But if you go really quick to Rebels, Rebels begins, first season of Rebels begins 5 years before episode 4, A New Hope, right? Before the Battle of Yavin. Yes. And so the four seasons of Rebels takes place roughly over that 5 years. Now, it ends with, you know, Ezra and Thrawn hyperspacing out into space.
Yeah.
The Battle of Lothal ends. And I'm not talking about the epilogue, because, right, there's an epilogue at the end of season 4 Rebels that kind of fast forwards. But if you're talking about just the battle at the end of season 4 where the battle ends, that's right, roughly about a year before episode 4.
Okay.
Now, if you remember, though, let's talk about where Ahsoka is at this time, right? Because this is where it gets a little confusing. And I kind of brought this up about the world between worlds really kind of throws a wrench into a lot of things, right? So about three episodes left in the series, right? In season 4, it was like episode 12 or 13. Ezra goes into the world between worlds, sees Ahsoka fighting Vader, pulls her out, basically saves her life, right? Do you remember these episodes? Have you seen these, right?
Oh, yeah.
And then when she goes back, remember, when she goes back into her timeline, she's now going a couple years in the past. So she's not at the same timeline, right, as Ezra is at that point. So when Ezra says, come find us, she runs back in. So within those two years of when Ezra gets back and Ahsoka now survives, because previously she wasn't involved in those 2 years in the timeline.
Oh, man.
And now she is. So this is a whole nother can of worms.
Yeah.
That part I don't know. That's one of the things I would love to ask Filoni and pick his brain about. Where is she those 2 years now between seasons 2 and 4 when she comes back after that battle with Vader, right? We don't know. No, nothing's ever been said about it yet. But so all we know is that she's alive, but she has not crossed paths with our ghost crew by the end of the series. So now we got to fast forward. Now that epilogue that talks about how Zeb goes with his people to that distant planet, that new home, talks about Hera fighting in the rebellion, because we know Hera fought through the battle of through the original trilogy battles. She was at the Battle of Endor and all this stuff. She was at the Battle of Jakku and all this stuff. So, and Chopper obviously was with her, and then she has her son, Jason Syndulla, which I'm assuming will probably meet in live action and also in this series. But then you had that very last scene where Ahsoka comes and picks up Sabine on Lothal, and that's the last shot of Rebels season 4 where they fly off. Now it was kind of understood that maybe that's about a year or two after Return of the Jedi. But now we know, based on the series, they recreated that scene
at
the end of episode 2, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So now where are we now in this timeline now? So basically this is parallel to obviously The Mandalorian and the Book of Boba Fett. But that's where it gets a little hairy, right? Because we talked about it during The Mandalorian. It was like, how many years have gone by from season 1 to season 2 to season 3? It hasn't been fully vetted out yet. But it's somewhere between 9 years to 11 years after A New Hope, which is about 5 to 7 years after Return of the Jedi. So that's where typically we are. Now, if you remember, season two of Mandalorian is when she captures Morgan Elsbeth, right? So you got to think that this is not that far from there. But according to Mandalorian, that's before Grogu went to Luke. And we're being told that Luke and Grogu were together for like 2 years.
Right, right.
So there's no way that that's true, to be, in my opinion. If that would mean Morgan Elsbeth has been in custody for 2 years before this whole thing starts going down. I guess that's possible, but to me it's not. So I think that timeline has shrunk a little bit back down to being only, you know, it's only been a year or two through the whole series of these shows.
Right.
So that's where, but either way, we're somewhere between 9 and 11 years after A New Hope. We're about 5 to 7 years after Return of the Jedi,
somewhere in that range, because Ahsoka shows up on the Mandalorian and she shows up in the Book of Boba Fett,
correct?
And she's with Luke and she's helping Grogu and she helps the Mando, and you know, she stays behind. So there's some time period in there that she's with Luke and she's not doing what she's doing in this show, which coincides with why when she finally meets up with Sabine and there's that whole discussion, like, hey, it's been a couple years, it's been a long time. Whatever, you left me, where have you been? Well, this kind of answers, oh, well, she's obviously been with Luke at some time. She's been helping Grogu at some time. There's been just pieces of her time away from Sabine as to what she's been doing up to this point. Because when we hear them say it's been years, like, well, okay, what is years? 2 years? 5 years? What do they mean when they say that? It's been years since we've done that or since I've seen you. You know, because it sounded like Sabine herself said it's been years since Ahsoka left her. Well, okay.
Yes, and it has been, I'm sure, because if you remember, so basically from the end of Rebels season 4 to now, it's been at least 10 years.
Right.
So there's a 10-year gap there that we just don't know how long they were together, how long they were training,
yeah,
and you know, how long Ahsoka's been on her own.
Right.
But there definitely is... The season, the Book of Boba Fett appearance by Ahsoka, honestly, really becomes an odd placement for her, because she captures Morgan Elsbeth, and now she's going after a map that she apparently got the information from Morgan. So, at some point in between there, we're told that she went and visited Luke and ran into the Mandalorian to Din there.
Yeah.
So somehow that went, you know, she took time away from doing this to do that, you know, so it is a little off, but somebody's keeping track of this.
It's possible. I mean, she's on a mission to get info from Morgan Elsbeth, and she gets the info and then she heads off on her own. But during that course of time, she gets called by Grogu preying on that Jedi stone. And she diverts her path. Oh, I better go see what that is. And she shows up. There's a new Jedi. I better check this out. Goes and check out. Meets Grogu. Meets Din Djarin. Deals with that little situation. And then she continues on her way to continue finding the map, which is, I think, what leads into the opening shot of her in this episode in that ancient Roman like city. So that she eventually finally gets to the spot where she was trying to get to find the map. So. Because Morgan's been in prison all this time too, right?
Yes, and we don't know how long that's been, but yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, what would be cool, I think what would be interesting to connect it would be, well, I don't, they couldn't show it now, but you know, if she had gone to Luke maybe to get some questions answered regarding Thrawn maybe, or regarding, you know, this map. That would kind of explain why she was there, kind of thing. But it is getting a little. I don't think it's fully messy yet, but it's getting hard to keep track.
And I think they need to somehow, if they're getting this organized with the eras, they need to organize this info for us, because I'm sure Filoni and Favreau and all the guys and the producers, they're probably seeing the confusion online that's out there. And I don't think, I think themselves, as big of fans as they are, I don't think they're going to like that. I think they're going to have to fix it, because once they catch wind of it, they're going to be, oh, wait a second, we got to clear that up, because we're big fans and we don't want to be confused.
Right.
So, yeah, we'll have to see. You never know. We'll come around to some of those points again, though. We'll be talking about some of these things as we go along. But the last thing I want to talk about in these opening moments of the episode is the movie-like quality. Right away, it felt like we were sitting in the theater watching the next big film. I mean, it had everything, and everything was cinematic and Hollywood-level quality. I mean, there was so much in there. Even, like, the opening scroll, the opening spaceship shot, the opening moments, the big battle scene. I mean, we got old Star Wars uniforms, we got old props, we got the set design. It all felt to me like they took 1977's A New Hope and polished it up to make it look new enough to continue making a TV show about it. Like all the 70s, 80s stuff from the trilogy, it was all right here. It just looked the same, only newer.
Yeah, it looked really good. I think the advancements of the volume have really changed and improved over the last few years, and you can't really tell anymore. I think it's really incredible what it looks like.
I mean, even the soldiers in the hallway that were getting shot up, they had those weird elongated bicycle helmets from The New Hope, and they had all the, it's just everything. It just felt, it was a very nostalgic opening that just like, wow, this is Star Wars all over again. It's very, very cool. Now, protocol droids, the next point I want to bring up. There was a lot of C-3PO relatives around. We had black ones, we had red ones, we had silver ones. They were all over the place in the background. Some of them were part of the crew. We had two of them speak, and both of them had female voices this time around. And one was designated as C-1D-1, so that was her name. That was the one that was at the Corellian shipyard, C-1D-1. But we had one all the way back in the opening shot of that spaceship. It was also a female protocol droid. So I wanted to ask you, I mean, it's just cool to see all these guys, all these different color variations of C-3PO, but what denotes whether one is going to be female or male sounding? I mean, they all look the same. There's no physical characteristics on these droids that give you a visual clue that one's a boy or one's a girl. So when does the choice come for them to sound female or sound male? And are they truly a he and a she, or is it just that's just a voice box? Like, I don't know.
I think it's just the program, what you want to make it sound. Probably can change the voice. Just like
you think you can change the voice?
Just like you can tell Alexa to be a British woman or a Australian man. You know, I think it's just the way the voice comes out.
Cool.
Yeah.
Okay. It's got, because, I mean, the droids even refer to themselves as he or she. Like, every time anyone talks about R2, they say, oh, yeah, he's got a lot of attitude today, or he's in trouble. Like, they do refer them to as male or female. So
true. Yeah. True. I don't know if I'd have to really think if we heard someone call a droid a she. L3 was a she, right?
Yeah. So maybe when they're programmed initially, they get designated he or she.
Yeah, that's what they are. That could be. It could be. Yeah. Yep.
Okay. Cool. But hey, lots of protocol droids
nice.
Around.
Yeah.
I wonder if they just take all of the old C-3PO costumes and just spray paint them instead of making new ones. Like, they probably have a few C-3PO's lying around. So I'll just paint this one black. I'll just paint that one red.
Yeah.
I just want to bring up Baylan Skull and Shin Hati real quick. We're going to dive into all the characters much more seriously in the bounty section. But what an intro to these two new characters. Very reminiscent of Darth Vader when he boards Leia's ship in the opening of A New Hope.
Yeah. Very reminiscent. Felt very A New Hope. I think it was a little bit of a callback for Filoni to George. Like, that was George's first scene, and this is his first scene.
Yeah.
You know, as a creator.
Yep. I think so, because it's attacking a ship, boarding the ship, and then cutting down all the soldiers in the hallway and taking, like, yeah. Mm-hmm. Very reminiscent.
Yeah.
Very, very cool. But we'll talk about that more later. It was just a really neat scene. So let's talk about that planet that Ahsoka gets her first scene on. It's very, and I already mentioned, it's very Roman-like. Like, it's got this ancient planet, this ancient Rome architecture and everything. It seems like it's lifeless. There's nothing there anymore. It seems like a very distant, faraway planet to get to. But we do find out a little bit later that's called Arcana. And we find out that it is ancient, because thousands of years ago, it was home to a stronghold built by the Night Sisters of Dathomir. And we'll get to that later. We'll talk about the Night Sisters a little bit later. But I just thought, wow, okay, so this is an ancient planet. It didn't look like anything lives there anymore thousands of years ago, but it just happened to have this stronghold, and that's where Ahsoka was going to find the map thing. So it's cool.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff coming, it seems like, from the Night Sisters. A lot of stories that they're diving into with about that.
Yeah. We'll come around to the Night Sisters in a little bit, but it's just a planet. I've never heard of Arcana before. Have you heard of Arcana? Because I looked it up. There's no information on it anywhere.
It's new.
Like we've talked about in every new Star Wars show, they're just making up planets as they go. Like, they're recreating the Star Wars galaxy.
Mm-hmm.
With a lot of new planets. So this one was just fun. Like, I love the look of it. Just, like I said, Roman-type architecture, pillars and everything, white stone all over the place. And I love that aesthetic. It just gives you that ancient feel, that Indiana Jones style and aesthetic, that you get to explore ancient tombs and solve puzzles, you know, very Tomb Raider-like. And, I mean, come on, Indiana Jones and Star Wars, that's a perfect match made in heaven.
Well, interesting you say Indiana Jones, because the entire first episode of Ahsoka, I kept getting the feeling that this was Jedi Fallen Order on the screen also.
Okay. Is that what the game is like?
Oh, you haven't played the game?
I haven't gone through it yet.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. It, like, the whole thing Ahsoka was doing with the moving the pillars and lining up, like, that is what you do in Jedi Fallen Order.
Oh, wow. Okay.
It's all these puzzles that you got to figure out. Maps that you're trying to figure out. I'm telling you, it was a very big parallel between the game and this show. I feel like Filoni took a lot of elements from that game and put it in this. Yeah. So, if very much so. And you probably don't have it on. I don't think I saw it in the notes, but I'll bring it up later. Because do you know what a Force Echo is? See, in the game, you learn how to do a Force Echo, which is you go to a scene and you can feel the presence and kind of hear the replay of what happened.
Okay, I did bring that up later, yeah.
Okay, which is what Ahsoka does.
Okay. Well, then I'll ask you that, yeah, because that's when we talk about Ahsoka in the bounty section. Okay, a Force Echo. Cool. Yeah, hang on to that thought.
Yes.
Okay. Well, I just thought, like, Ahsoka's down in an ancient tomb and she's doing Indiana Jones type puzzles and manipulation, and, you know, like I said, very Tomb Raider, if you guys are fans of the Tomb Raider games, which I am. It just had all of that. When you put these two things together, it's a perfect match, because I think we've talked about it on the show before. Star Wars is about a long time ago, a galaxy far, far away, and just within the Star Wars lore, we know we're like 25,000, 30,000 years of lore just in our stories that we're getting. These worlds have been around for a long time, and there's civilizations that have risen and fallen and disappeared and risen and fallen again. And there's so much stuff, so much mystery, so much things to explore and to discover, because there's some alien species that died out 12,000 years ago, and now you're visiting their planet. And you're checking out what they've left behind. I mean, that's Indiana Jones 101 right there. And yet it's part of the Star Wars world. And that's just, I love it. I know there's that other character, Dr. Aphra, that's kind of into all of that. I would just love to see a Star Wars series that's all about exploration and discovering all the planets and all the ancient history that's out there. That would be cool.
Well, it sounds like that's what that game is going to be about, too, that open world game.
Oh, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. That'd be cool. Outlaws?
Outlaws. Yep.
Yeah. So it's pretty exciting. Pretty exciting when they put these things together. Definitely enjoy it. Now, when she comes out of that tomb, there's these... She gets surrounded by droids. Well, first, there's a face-off one-on-one, and the droid says, you know, give the map to us. And she's like, us? And then the other droids start dropping in. Yes, us, us, us. And there ended up being five of them. I don't know what kind of droids they are. I'm just calling them guardian droids, because until we discuss it, I didn't really know what to call them. But later on in the episode, we get a mention of them being HK something assassin droids. Is that what they were?
Yes, they are HK-87s, I think. HK-87 assassin droids.
Hmm.
Okay. But they haven't been... Like, their only appearance has been these shows.
So, these are new droids, then. These assassin droids showing up in a timeline in Star Wars that is relatively new to everything we've had already. Except for the sequels, of course. But it's kind of... I find it interesting because this isn't a time period when the Empire doesn't count on droids anymore. They got rid of all the droids and replaced them with stormtroopers and stuff. So it's kind of interesting that we're seeing these new droids come into play on these shows in that time period when the Empire's like, yeah, no, we're not relying on droids anymore.
Yeah, I don't think they fully got rid of them. I mean, maybe battle droids for sure.
But as
I think
their main army, I guess. Yeah,
yeah, but these assassin droids are, you know, usually you see them with high-level officials or high-level ranking officers. Of course, right. Morgan, being a high-level person, she had them with her all the time, so...
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
They're pretty efficient. Like, they're good... I mean, they're well programmed in whatever style of fighting they're using.
Yeah.
They're, and a droid is obviously a lot stronger than a living being, so, man, you gotta be careful around those things.
Yeah, very similar to the droids, if you remember the... Kind of the guardian assassin droids that Grievous had with him, always,
right.
In episode 3.
Yeah, right. You're right. Well, let me ask you then, like, these guardian droids, these HKs, do you think they were stationed there on Arcana protecting the map, or were they tracking Ahsoka and followed her there because they were sent by Morgan Espeth to get the map from her?
Yeah, that's a good question. I think... Since she revealed to Ahsoka where the map is, I would have to guess that somehow they knew she was going after it, and they followed her there. I don't imagine them being planted there and just sitting there waiting.
No, but we'll talk about that map, but a lot more in detail. I think Morgan knew where it was, and she gave the information to Soak, but I don't think Morgan had been there yet. I think nobody had gotten to it yet. She just discovered how to find it, and Ahsoka discovered from her how to find it, and they were basically... Because she just seemed surprised, like, yeah, Ahsoka found it. And that's why I'm kind of thinking she sent the droids after her to go get it from her. It's kind of my feeling.
Yeah. It's possible. I think... Yeah, either that or she knew... Well, there's a whole big question that I think we're going to talk about later. There's a big question of how the map even exists.
That's coming right up, yeah.
So,
right now, like, what I'm trying to cue on is what did Morgan tell Ahsoka about the map back in Mandalorian when she defeats her? They're fighting each other so Ahsoka can get the information, and she tells her about it.
Yeah, but see, I don't necessarily get the sense that she willingly told her. I feel like Ahsoka almost kind of read her mind in a sense of where it could be.
Okay.
So I don't know why she would willingly tell her where it is, right? So I think she even mentioned something like, I extracted it from her, or I got the information from her. Like, I don't think she was told. I think she just got told where it could be, and she went there looking for it.
She went there looking for it, yeah. Because Morgan she seemed a little bit surprised that she found it. Like, oh, crap, Ahsoka's there already. Like, she found it? Okay, we gotta go.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah. Not sure. Okay, well, let's talk about the star map. It is my next point. So, this could be a bounties-type question, but I wanted to get out of the way here because it was a major focus point of the show. And I need to know, why in the galaxy would there even be a star map showing where Thrawn is? Who made it? Who put it there? Why? And why is it buried in this tomb, like surrounded by all these traps and puzzles to get to it, and then it's encased in dirt? I mean, what the hell? Why? What is this thing doing there that's a direct A to B, you know, drawing of where Thrawn is? I don't understand. Why does this thing exist, and where did it come from?
Huge, huge plot point right now that doesn't really make a lot of sense. You're right.
Because last we saw, Thrawn was grabbed by Ezra, thrown out the bridge window of a spaceship, and then taken by the Purgles into hyperspace to who knows where. We had no idea where. They just, whoosh, hyperspaced out of there. So how could there be a map of that? Like nobody knew where he was going.
Yeah, that's a... Well, I think there's a couple points that we have to look at. One, if Arcana is this ancient civilization, you know, 1,000 years old, right? Mm-hmm. Like you just said, how would the map be there in that room? And with those kind of, you know, settings that you have to do in order to get it.
Yeah.
Which again, makes me kind of think that Morgan hid it there. Like she's already seen it, or at least has the map and didn't know, really know how to or where to unlock it, right? Because that's what we kind of discover in the next episode, how to see the map, how to read the map.
Yeah.
So she almost kept it there, maybe kept it there. But she also mentions later that Thrawn is telling her, right, where he is.
Yeah.
I don't understand how that's possible.
because of the other galaxy and all that kind of stuff. So I have those points coming up in the bounty section where we'll dive into
force,
that stuff.
I don't think he's not force sensitive.
Yeah. Yeah.
So I don't, you know, I guess we can talk about it more later, but my opinion, mm-hmm. I'm leaning towards the fact that it's not Thrawn actually communicating with her.
Okay. I was wondering about that myself. So we'll talk about that in the bounty section, but right now the point about the map itself, it doesn't make any sense why there is such a thing in existence. Because the way I just described, the way Thrawn left, there shouldn't be any knowledge of that, and there shouldn't be any knowledge for sure left here, buried deep in a tomb, to describe where he is and to give you a path to get to him. Because there's no sense in that at this point in the episode, and this point that we're talking about it. We'll get into it a little bit more in bounties. It's just I'm just really confused as the purpose of this thing and how it got here and who sent it here, or who put it there, who created it, which those points come up later. But it's because I don't know if they wrote this part of the show for people that have no idea what happened in Rebels, because then it would make sense. Oh, hey, there's this map to find this guy. Cool. Okay, get it. We'll go find him. But when you're a Rebels fan and you know what happened to Thrawn, that's where the disconnect is.
Yeah.
It's not like the Purgles pooped out a map to say, this is where we're going, see ya, and left it behind when they flew away.
Right.
You know?
Yeah. You know, and then it's a big question of the whole thing about another galaxy. How can you even... Do they even have star charts that outside their own galaxy? You know?
I got so many questions for you when we get to that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just when we thought we're going to have perfect writing and everything's going to be explained. I mean, maybe that's just the mystery of the show, right? Like that.
Well, I think they'll get there. Yeah.
They'll get there. Yeah, it's just a big mystery, but we'll see. We'll see what happens here. Let's move on. We'll come around to some of that stuff again. Let's talk about Lothal. We got Lothal in live action, Vizsla, and man, was it beautiful to see. We see the city of the towers. We see the super highway out to those landing pads that we have witnessed many chase sequences on in all the animated movies and, you know, episodes and stuff. There's so many times we saw that long racing strip out towards the tower. where Ezra is, his family tower out in the desert there. It was just so dang cool to see all of that come to life. Oh my gosh.
Yeah, it was gorgeous. Absolutely gorgeous.
Yeah. It was so cool. They really, I mean, they brought it to life as if it's been one of our Star Wars planets all along. Just cool. Very cool. And like, every detail was almost identical. Like, it looked like they just turned the animation into live action.
Yes, and then released it. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it was crazy. I mean, we even got Lothcats. I mean, they were there, and they looked so alive and so real. And I want to ask you, do you think the Lothcats were CGI, or was that an animatronic like Grogu?
I think it was animatronic.
I think so, too. Yeah. It looked too real, man.
Yeah, and they were interacting with it pretty closely, so.
Yeah.
I think it was.
Yeah, I think so. Cool to see them, too. Like, Star Wars critter. The Empire sure knows how to make creepy-ass probe droids. Tracking droids, interrogation droids, you name it. The Empire makes it, and they're creepy. And this time, we get a baseball-sized tracking droid. And you never even noticed that thing was following you, because it's the size of a ball. That's it. And it was floating around, and it was tracking down Sabine, and when it spotted her, it flew all the way across the prairie and let Shin there know exactly what it saw. Like, man, Empire and their droids, eh?
That was very reminiscent of Darth Maul.
Was it?
Episode 1. Yeah, when he had the tracking.
Oh, yeah, you're right.
The probe droids out there tracking Qui-Gon.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. He sent a bunch of them out, yeah. Yep. Cool little guys. I want to talk about the lightsaber duels here, just because this is one of those wow moments that the spectacle that we got to witness in these two episodes of lightsaber duels. We had Ahsoka taking on those guardian droids, then Sabine taking on Shin Hati, and then Ahsoka again against a droid and what looks like an Inquisitor. We'll talk about him in the bounty section. Cool. Just some cool lightsaber fights. Oh my gosh. The battles are getting better and better. They're so well choreographed, so well performed. The sound effects, the moves, the ideas they keep introducing to lightsaber fights to keep it fresh and exciting and not like, not another lightsaber fight. Like, every single time, it's like, whoa, that was awesome.
Yes, it was. They were really, really good. And one point I read was the very first live action lightsaber duel between two females.
Get out. Was it really?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, because Rey never fought any other ladies. We never saw Leia really fight.
Nope. Not with a lightsaber.
Well, did Asajj Ventress fight Ahsoka at any point in the animations?
Live action.
You said live action. You're right. Okay. So Rey really would be the only one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Very cool.
Very cool.
I mean, the choreography, these fights were amazing.
Yes, amazing.
Oh, they were cool. Really cool. I mean, I don't know how long these guys practice for, but I know some of these actors are very well trained in acrobatics and martial arts, and yeah, I mean, it shows. It pays off when they're getting into those fights.
Months and months.
This is not Obi-Wan and Darth Vader from A New Hope lightsaber duel anymore.
No, they need to redo that one.
Yeah. It's cool stuff for sure. So here's a nostalgic poll for you. The medical droid that we seen working on Sabine for her lightsaber cut there, which we'll talk about in a moment, is the same type of doctor droid that was working on Luke when he lost his hand to Darth Vader. And I was just waiting for him to speak to see if he sounded the same, because that would have been hilarious if it was the same guy.
Yeah. They all pretty much sound the same, I feel like. They're all medical droids. Yeah. So.
He didn't say anything, though. So, but it looked exactly the same, which is kind of cool. And this is the first time we've actually seen him head to toe. We've only ever seen his torso up. But this time you could see him standing at the console, and you could see what kind of legs he had.
Yeah, right.
It's kind of fun.
Mm-hmm.
How about Corellia, Vizsla? We get to go to Corellia again. Not since the movie Solo have we seen Corellia. And Solo was a long time ago, so this is Corellia in the current time.
Yes. Yeah, this is years later. Yeah. But Corellia has always been, shipyards and manufacturing and all that stuff.
Well, that's what it is, yeah, the vast shipyard yards and stuff. But what we saw here, we saw it in nice bright daylight. There's lots of water, lots of lakes. It's a very Earth-like planet. Its landmass, I was looking up in the Star Wars Atlas and the images of it. It's got a lot more landmass than Earth does, but it seems to be all together, and then it's just surrounded by water. It says that they're also known for its beautiful beaches and mountains, Corellia, which I didn't know. Mm-hmm. I thought it was maybe more of an industrial planet. I had no idea it was so lush with the blueness and stuff like that in the water. But the book also said it's gone through some political upheaval. Once under the control of the Empire, when that ended, the political people pulled away and didn't want to be part of the New Republic or anything. They wanted to be their own planet and their own run their own system and stuff. So that's kind of interesting. We don't hear a lot about that kind of stuff with a lot of the planets. So.
No.
Yeah. That's kind of cool. But neat that Corellia is here and we get to visit a... Because that name Corellia, I mean, the Millennium Falcon, Corellian ships, like we always hear about Corellian something or other. So
right.
To get to come to the planet and see a different version, a different perspective of it, is cool.
Yep.
But
definitely.
Yeah, shipyards. When they flew in over it, just big, it looked like islands, just shipyard, 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 everywhere.
Everywhere.
Every platform. Yeah, majority building a new of ship.
It. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's really cool. Now, one of the characters that we met there, his name was Min Weaver. Now, he was kind of like the shipyard manager. I don't know if you recognize that actor. His name is Peter Jacobson.
I recognize him. I can't remember where I've seen him from, though.
Well, he's very familiar because he always plays good weasels. Just like he did here, that is the character type that he is good at. Everything I've ever seen him, whether it's a movie or TV show, he plays this exact same type of weaselly character. He sounds like he's trying to help you out, but he's not. He's always got another agenda. He's going to backstab you. You can never trust him. And as soon as I saw him here, I knew, don't trust that guy. Nope, he's feeding you a bunch of BS. Don't trust him.
Right.
Yep. So, Min Weaver. I. Who knows if he'll come into play again or not.
Yeah, probably not. He's going to jail, looks like.
Yeah, he got taken away, right? Let's talk about the droid. Hugh Yang. Because I swear one of the characters says He Yang in there, but... let's talk about him, though. So I want you to remind us, because we talked about it during the Ahsoka trailers, but tell us his story again, how old he is and what his purpose was, because it's pretty fascinating.
He is from the beginning, so he's about 25,000 years old.
And that's crazy, because when Sabine asks him how he's doing, are you all in one piece? He says, yeah, and 75% of original parts.
75% is about 25,000 years old.
That's some good-ass droid parts.
Right, and he's, I don't know exactly what he was doing in the very beginning or even for the first few thousand years, but in the most recent years that we know of, he was in charge of helping Padawans, younglings transitioning to Padawans, build their sabers.
Right. So, like, when you say helping, did he, like, instruct them, this is how you do it? Or did he show them, like, what?
Pretty much showed them what they needed to do. You know, once they got their crystals.
To put the components together.
They had to put all their components together and pick their components and things like that. So he would help them construct them.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so that was his duties, basically.
That was his duties. At least, again, like what we've seen him in the Clone Wars.
Okay.
What'd he do for 25,000 years? probably much of the same, but...
Is there a style of droid that is he? He's not a protocol droid. Like, what series is he?
Yeah, I don't know. I haven't seen anything like him, So he's probably unique. It'd be interesting to figure out... Which we may in the Dawn of the Jedi movie figure out who actually creates him.
Yeah, exactly. Well, the fact that they used to build droids 25,000 years ago, mm-hmm. and that he can still function. Like, imagine, we always talk about the amount of stuff that R2 has witnessed and what's in his memory banks. What about Young here?
Oh, like, yeah, yeah.
He's... Oh my gosh. Like, his memory banks, he's got to be upgraded with brand new memory chips or hard drives, because he's got to be overloaded by now.
Yeah,
that's insane.
And to I guess to gotta assume that his memory's never been wiped, so he probably has all this memory still.
Yeah. And did you notice they kind of gave him eyelids? It's the first time I've ever seen a droid with eyelids. Because there's a lot of shots where he had facial expression.
Yeah.
So you could see like little, you know, eyelids come down and kind of cover his eyes a little bit when he's making a face or a gesture, and he looked sad or he looked worried or he looked whatever. I was like, I've never seen a droid have attachments to his eyes where he could have more expression.
Yeah.
That was kind of cool.
It was kind of cool.
So he is voiced by David Tennant, and a lot of you out there should know who that is, the 10th Doctor on Doctor who I personally think was the best Doctor ever. David Tennant voiced him in the Clone Wars, and now he gets to play him in live action, which I think is really cool. And apparently, there's a story behind him. He was known to be a huge Star Wars fan, and David Filoni actually went up to him and offered him a role to be part of the Star Wars universe, because at the time, his wife was making him watch Doctor Who, and he remembered loving David Tennant's turn as Doctor Who. And he thought, wow, if he's a Star Wars fan, I'm going to go get a Doctor Who to be in Star Wars somehow. And that's when they got him to be Yang.
Nice.
So, yeah, kind of a fun story there. I found him pretty funny, though, in this. Like, this is the first time. I don't remember him in Clone Wars. I'm going to have to go back and find the episodes that he's in. I don't remember seeing him. But what I love about him is that he's very matter-of-fact. He doesn't sugarcoat anything. He just tells you how it is, doesn't care if it hurts your feelings. This is what it is.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's only in a couple episodes, like two or three episodes of The Clone Wars.
Oh, is he? Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He's pretty funny. I think he's going to be our droid of this series.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah. Yeah. There's always one, right? Always one. This time, because we've had a lot of R2 style units and stuff lately, so this is going to be our, you know, we're going to have a walking, talking one for this go around.
Yes.
Which is fun. And Chopper. We got Chopper too. Who I have next on the list, because I tell you, watching Chopper in this, he didn't have a lot to do in this, but he had one really big scene during that action sequence with Hera, but you'd swear that the cartoon just came to life. This is Chopper exactly as he is in Star Wars Rebels. I mean, all his sounds, all his attitudes, all his movements, everything. The animation just came to life. There's not a thing different about him.
I totally agree. I thought they did an outstanding job with Chopper. His full personality is transitioned really well. Yeah,
it was crazy. Everything.
His movement was pretty on point. I mean, it was, yeah, it was pretty incredible.
Pretty crazy to see him come to life. Yeah, it's just funny. So, what series of droid is he again?
Oh, CP is like a CP something. CP one, I think, is his designation, right?
It's a type of astromech, though, right?
Like, yeah, he's an astromech. Line. Yeah.
Yeah. So, what I want to ask about Chopper is he's got those arms that come out of his head with little hands on them. Do all of his series of droid have that, or is he somehow custom? Because we know R2 has the little pincer that comes out of his chest, and he's always grabbing things and doing things like that, but Chopper has them come out of his head, and he uses them like hands and arms.
Yeah, I think it's... Yeah, I think it's just maybe what it comes with. He is a C1... It's a C-series. He's a C1 astromech.
Okay.
So he's not an R series.
Yeah.
It's a C series. C1.
So he's probably a lot older C1 than R2, 10P. I guess. Say that C series is pretty old.
I'm sure they're all old, you know. Droids have been around for thousands of years, so.
Yeah.
But, you know, I don't know if all of them have the same pieces, you know, as part of their their construction, but they all have capabilities of that, like R2. I mean, R2, we're still finding things that R2 has that we never knew about either, so.
Yeah,
you know.
I think R2's had some custom jobs over the years, because he's got things no other R2 units have.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. I think Luke's been tinkering around with him.
But it says Chopper's got an arc welder, a rocket booster, a computer probe, electroshock pro, fire extinguishers, holo projectors, buzz saws. You know, so grasping arms, three of them.
Wow.
So, okay. He's equipped.
He is. But I found it funny because being Chopper that is, he's swinging his arms around. He's happy, whatever. But I love after they did their little successful mission when they threw that tracking device, he flexes his arms. He's like,
yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, he does.
Pretty funny. Pretty funny character. And he's always cranky. He's always complaining. And that really came across in this because he's trying to find his whatever part. And he's blaming Hera. Did you go through my stuff? No, I didn't go through your stuff.
Yeah.
Like he's... the fact that he's actually got attachment to things. And it's just funny. He's a funny droid. I want to ask you, there's a scene when Sabine is on Ahsoka's ship and they're starting to get their relationship going again, and she's walking around the ship and she goes into the crew quarters there where all the bunks are, and she crouches down to one of the lower bunks and she's looking at all these drawings on the wall in one of the bunks. Whose were those? Was that her old bunk and she was just reminiscing about staying on the ship, or was that Ezra's drawings? Because they started talking about Ezra right away, so I was kind of confused. Whose artwork was that?
Pretty sure they were her artwork.
Because she's the artist. She's the one that's always drawing.
Yeah, Ezra never was on that ship, I don't believe. Because he was gone. He's been gone this whole time.
Yeah. Even in Rebels, before they took off, he never... Because Ahsoka was around a little bit, but...
Well, that's what I was saying. Yeah. She wasn't around because she was dead.
Yeah.
And he saves her finally later, so... Yeah. So it should be Sabine's artwork. Sabine's.
Okay. So she was just having a little reminiscing memory lane type of moment there. Okay. You know what I really want to get into is the aerial combat and the spaceships on this show. They have perfected the look of their spaceship sequences. It actually looks like it's really happening. It's easy to pull that off against the blackness of space. You just throw spaceships up against a black background and it looks all cool and stuff, but when they're planet side, and I've noticed them doing this a lot in The Mandalorian, I remember us talking about that, it looks so real. When we see Hera and the Phantom and she's chasing after that, you know, that freighter ship and stuff, everything looks so real. It reminded me of like Top Gun Maverick. They actually use fighter jets to get their sequences on film, and Tom Cruise is actually filming and flying and learning how to do all that. It looks like they're doing the same thing here. They've got actual Star Wars ships flying around the atmosphere. It's so impressive. I'm so impressed by how good it looks.
Yeah, I think they've always looked good. I think what's selling the realism is the way it's moving. You know, it's very much like it's details. It's very much what, you know, the evolution of 3D objects in movies. You know, you never really could get the shadows right or the lighting right on it, and the reflections and stuff like that. Now you're able to do those things. Just makes things more real and harder to identify. And I think these ships, just the way they're moving and the way, you know, is piloting it, it makes it look more real to me when I see something like that versus something that looks like a model just kind of floating around, you know, kind of thing. So,
it's got that depth. Like when the camera's like above and the ships are flying at the camera and you see the city below, it gives you that depth, that perspective of they're taking off from the city and they're going higher and higher. Because we all know what that looks like when we take an airplane somewhere. And that's why it looks so real, because you're like, whoa, there's the city behind them, and it's falling away as they're lifting off into the stratosphere. It's impressive. It really is what they're doing with that. Yeah, because I mean, other shows that don't do graphics as well, and even the older Star Wars movies and stuff, I mean, you could tell there's like a little outline. You could tell that it's been cut out or it's been superimposed on top of something, because there's like a little outline. You don't see that anymore on
this. Yeah, you haven't seen that in a while. But yeah.
Oh, it's just beautiful. Just love it. Well, I got one last point here in our Cantina Chatter section, and that's the ending credits. we get a very Game of Thrones like credit sequence for the end of the show, for the ending credits here, as we watch a map being drawn out in space with some type of ancient language at each point of intersection on the map there. And I thought it was very, very cool. But I want to ask you here, do you think this is the same map that's in the ball, like the map that the ball projected out into the open air? And is it kind of showing us, is this kind of a hint of showing us where the series might go? Like, where they're showing us, because I can't read, I have no idea what language that was. Maybe you could look at it and recognize it and maybe even translate it. I think I saw somebody online saying they're translating the map, so that might be very cool. But I'm wondering if that map is giving us a clue as to where they're going to be going. I don't know. What do you think?
I kind of thought that, you know, it looks like, because the sequence ends when it reaches a certain point.
Yeah.
So I feel like, yes, I feel like it's giving us a hint at the journey that we're going to be taking with Ahsoka and these characters as they try to find where Ezra and Thrawn are.
Right.
So I think it's, yeah, I think it's basically doing that. I don't know how it can technically reveal, you know, us anything, but I don't know if it matters, because I think we don't know what the names of these planets are. So,
well, as we'll get into it in the bounty section, it's obviously going to another galaxy, and it's a language we probably shouldn't know, so there's no way we should be able to translate it and get information from it.
Yeah, the lettering looked Mandalorian.
Oh.
But I haven't seen or really followed what a Mandalorian alphabet looks like or whatever, but
yeah,
the lettering very much looked, the shape of it very looked Mandalorian to me, which wouldn't fully make sense if,
no,
you know, if that map was made by somebody else.
Yeah, although Sabine Wren was the one that cracked the code to open it, but
right,
maybe she's translating it.
Could be.
Maybe that's her work. She's translating it and knows where it's going. Yeah, I don't know. But still, pretty cool sequence at the end. I mean, we've never had anything like that either in Star Wars.
No.
To end a show. Yeah. Very cool, man. Well, that is the end of Cantina Chatter. We are going to pause. I believe we might have some credit, some commercials thrown in here. I don't think I've ever brought that up on the show, Vizsla. I think it's just been happening. We've just been happening. Maybe we never let our fans know that we do have some advertising now on the show. It just helps pay. It helps bring in a little small amount of income to help pay for the cost of running the show. And I usually insert it in our breaks between sections. So you might get a couple ads now. You might not. I don't know. We'll see.
Got it.
But it's cool that they're in there now. But we are going to jump into our favorite scenes, which is our next section, and that's where we play our favorite clips from these episodes. And we're going to play one each from Master and Apprentice and Toil and Trouble. So, let's get into that.
I'm not here to team up with you. I need a diversion, and you're it.
All right, man. So, Master and Apprentice, let's kick it off with your favorite scene. What did you like from this first part?
Mine was probably a lot of the action sequences are probably my favorite, but if we're talking about some dialogue here.
Yeah.
Ahsoka, Sabine, you know, catching up, finally sitting down where they're talking about the map, but then getting into more, you know, personally what happened, you know, because there are a lot of question marks there of what happened with them over the last few years.
Yeah, and we're just starting to get a bit of that information, so that's when it'll come out. Yeah, let's listen to the clip. We'll talk after.
You really think Ezra's still out there?
Nothing is certain. However, our enemy is actively seeking Thrawn, which is what led me to the map.
Where did you find this?
In a world named Arcana. It was a stronghold for the witches of Dathomir. Thousands of years ago.
Witches. Great. This is getting more exciting by the minute. I take it these patterns have meanings.
You have the artist's eye. Tell me what you see. Well, no one would design a map you couldn't read. There must be a key or codex of some sort. Perhaps this will help. This is a scan Hu Yang took of the temple where we found it. So, where do you call home these days? The ship serves me fine. Still? Don't you ever get tired of moving from one place to another? I go where I'm needed. Not always. You never make things easy. Why should I? You never made things easy for me, Master. There is nothing easy about being a Jedi. Well, then I should have made a good one. Yes. You should have.
Lady Tano, I have an update.
Not right now, Hu Yang. Go ahead.
There you go. Yeah. It's just, we're starting to get a feeling of the relationship between the two of them. Because where were they at, if you remember, where were they at in Rebels? What kind of relationship did these two have? They're just kind of getting to know each other, weren't they?
Yeah, that's where, again, it gets a little interesting that Filoni's going down this road of master and apprentice between Ahsoka and Sabine, because again, Ahsoka wasn't in the series the last two seasons, right? Season 3 and season 4, she wasn't even in it because apparently she had, you know, gotten killed by Vader on Malachor. So it was more Ezra and Sabine and Kanan and Sabine. Kanan was helping her train to learn how to use the Darksaber.
Right. Yep.
You know, and things like that. So, you know, there wasn't really, she didn't have a relationship with Ahsoka, really. So it's interesting to know, it's interesting to find out, hopefully, how that even became a thing after Ezra. I'm assuming after Ezra disappeared and Ahsoka came around again, you know, she wanted to be trained by her, in a sense. I don't know. I don't know how that got initiated.
Hopefully we get flashbacks. We get, or in dialogue they tell us. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. You're right. Yeah, it's a cool moment. I'm going with one that is when Huang's analysis of the orange lightsabers gives us some details about them while he discusses it with Ahsoka, because Ahsoka has them scan the lightsabers and then look into them, and this is just their discussion in one of the back rooms of her ship. Here we go.
I see the two of you are getting reacquainted.
So what did you find?
As you requested, I have run an analysis on the lightsabers. The image was corrupted, but using my extensive database, I was able to reconstruct the details of the two hilts. They are quite elegant, with several classic design motifs.
It's all very fascinating, Hu Yang, but do you have any names?
Patience. This is where it gets interesting. The construction and overall design are executed exactly the way I taught younglings to build a lightsaber at the temple.
So definitely Jedi trained.
Yes. However, this one I do not recognize. But this one, in the last 500 years, I've only known one student who built a saber such as this. Balan Skoll. He disappeared at the end of the Clone Wars, like so many Jedi.
Master and an apprentice.
That would be my assumption. If both trained in the Jedi arts, they will be formidable adversaries. For you alone. Of course, you may not be alone for much longer.
Maybe. Thank you, Huye.
Yeah, so I think we're going to learn about Baylan's skull as the characters on the show learn about him. That's how we're going to find out his history, is when Ahsoka's trying to learn. That's the way they're going to be shown. I don't know if we're going to get backup shots or anything like that, or scenes. We might, but I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know about him. I don't know. I think we'll get more details about him, but yeah, it's going to be... It might not be as much as we want from the past.
Yeah. Yeah, it might just be all in dialogue. Just letting us know. But I don't know. I mean, I guess it depends on how strong this character is in the series, where they go with him. Because we don't know that. Everything. That's what's great. That's kind of what's exciting about Ahsoka, is all of this is new. We're not pulling on anything that we know from. It's all brand new, this territory. So,
yeah, right.
That's really cool. Well, let's play our favorite scenes from the second episode, which we've been discussing here and there. Toil and Trouble. I think mine is first. This is earlier in the episode. This is when Sabine was in the hospital and they brought her the droid head, and she was going to hook it all up and, you know, try to download the information from it. And I love Star Wars humor. It's my kind of humor. I just love how it gets written in and plays so smoothly into the scene without it being forced into the scene. It's just part of the scene. And this one with Sabine in the hospital and discussing blowing up the droid's head and Young's reaction to the blowing up made me laugh. So here's that one.
Take off an arm or leg and it just keeps coming. That means they have several built-in backup systems. And as a result...
Its memory core stays partially active even after termination.
And if you get the power levels right, you can recover the droid's memory.
And find out where it came from. Very clever.
So what happens if you get the power levels wrong?
The head will explode.
Explode?
Calm your circuits. Can pull the plug before it gets to that.
Perhaps we should perform this operation somewhere else.
I say go for it.
Because you're a hologram.
I mean, droids, he's got such a deadpan delivery, it just cracks me up. Like, but he's obviously worried about his own existence. And just the fact that he can acknowledge the humor in that point is just makes me laugh.
Yeah. That's pretty good.
Because you're a hologram. Like, it makes me laugh. But it's funny, David Tennant, I can't even tell that that's him. It doesn't sound like him at all. Like, it's a really good disguise of his voice.
It is. I can sometimes hear it. I can sometimes hear it, but no, most of the time I can't.
Yeah, really cool. Really, really cool. What one did you get for the second part here?
Yeah, mine was a little bit later when Sabine and Hu Yang are talking about her being trained again and talking about taking those next steps, you know, putting responsibility on herself to want to be trained.
Right. Here it is.
Ah, I see you still have your lightsaber.
Ezra's lightsaber.
True, he constructed it, and by all accounts it served him well. Then he passed it on to you. You have since made your own modifications. So it is now your lightsaber.
For all the good it did me.
Have you kept up with your training?
Obviously not.
Well, perhaps it is time to begin again.
I don't think that's up to me.
Really? Explain.
I can't train if Ahsoka doesn't want to teach me.
That is an excuse. And a poor one.
Hey. She quit on me.
The past is the past. Move forward.
Okay, but answer this. If you could have unlocked the map yourself, would Ahsoka have come here?
Irrelevant.
It's very relevant. Was I part of the plan? Was she going to tell me about Ezra, or was this little reunion Hera's idea?
General Syndulla thought your insights would be valuable. And Lady Tano agreed.
see? She doesn't want me back. She wasn't even thinking about me.
To be fair, you have never indicated that you want to come back.
Forgot how annoying you are.
Logical.
It doesn't matter. I never had the talent, the abilities. Not like Ezra.
That much is true.
Thanks.
I have known many Padawans over the centuries, and I can safely say your aptitude for the Force would fall short of them all.
Well then, I won't waste any more of her time.
The only time you are wasting is your own.
And that's where you hear his deadpan just tells you like it is.
Yeah, so that's a good scene.
Good scene there for sure. Yeah, good discussion with them. It's interesting because how well does Sabine know Hu Yang? Like, they have a relationship from previous time? Because if he's been, like, how long's he been with Ahsoka? Where'd he come from? We've never seen him on anything else before, so why is he hanging out with Ahsoka now?
No idea.
Yeah.
Lots of questions there that need to get answered.
Well, let's see if we can answer some of them in the bounty section where we get a little bit deeper into some of the stuff.
I would never let anyone hurt you, Ahsoka. Never.
The first thing I want to talk about is just the characters. Let's just go through some of the characters, just a quick breakdown on who they are and who's playing them and stuff and where you might recognize some of these people from before we dive right into stuff about them. So let's start off with a character we saw in this episode called Ryder Azadi, and he's played by Clancy Brown, who many of you recognize. Clancy has been everywhere. I mean, he's been in Star Wars for a while himself. He played Ryder Azadi in Rebels. He played Berg in The Mandalorian. He was also the Inquisitor in Tales of the Jedi. Plus, I mean, he's done everything. I've seen him on so many TV shows. It's almost countless. And he's voiced so many cartoons and video games. It's insane. This guy has been everywhere. And he's awesome.
Yeah, I thought it was really neat that they used the same character voice from Rebels.
Yeah.
So
he looks just like how they animated him.
Oh, exactly. Yeah.
Like,
and that's the thing, is they're doing that a lot now, is kind of making the animated characters look like the voice characters, you know, so.
Exactly.
Yeah. It translated really well.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. Let's talk about Ezra Bridger, because we only got a hologram message from him. He's played from Iman Esfandi. That guy's not really well known for anything big. He's done a few things, but nothing that we would know. You wonder, I mean, it depends on what kind of movies or TV shows you watch, but he hasn't done a lot. I thought the voice and the way he talks, I think he nailed Ezra. He sounded a lot like Ezra, but I wasn't sure about his look. I never really imagined Ezra as the kind of a Middle Eastern, East Indian kind of look. I always kind of thought Ezra was maybe Spanish or Mexican, maybe, in heritage, just the way he was animated on the show. So I looked up the actor because I wanted to find out what his background was, and it turns out he's Persian, which is a part of Iran. It's like, oh, okay. So I'm going to have to wait to see him in live action to really decide if I like him. I like the way he played the part. I just wasn't sure about his look. What did you think?
Yeah, I think he did look the part. I think Good. He looked and sounded the part. I mean, I think Ezra... Yeah, it's hard to say in animation, but Ezra had kind of a rugged kind of, yeah, I wouldn't say Persian really either when you first think about it, but I definitely could pull it off if he looks the part, but, you know, because his skin tone in Rebels was a little darker, you know, so, yeah, we'll just have to see him in real life, you know,
see him actually performing and acting and see how he does, yeah. When do you think we'll see him? When is Ezra going to show up?
I don't know. I'm because
you said not this season before.
He might not even show up this season, right?
Yeah.
It feels like this season's more about obviously Ahsoka and Sabine now and their relationship.
Yeah.
And Hera obviously helping with that, but
yeah,
it's more about finding Thrawn and. In preventing the war, like Ahsoka said, and they're obviously trying to find Ezra in the, but while doing that, so
right,
it might not get to that.
Yeah. I don't know. I it's hard to say. And then again, the show might surprise us, and they get to him next episode. Like for all we know, like
yeah. No, I think it's gonna be a little harder than that.
Yeah, we'll have to see. But all right, let's talk about Hera Syndulla, played by Mary Elizabeth Winstead. You guys, she's been all over the place. She's been in a lot of big projects recently. Birds of Prey, Gemini Man, 10 Cloverfield Lane, a couple of the Die Hard films. But I think her biggest role that most people recognize her from is Scott Pilgrim's Versus the World. She's married to Ewan McGregor, our very own Obi-Wan Kenobi. So there's her connection to Star Wars. She's been involved in the Star Wars world for a very long time, and now she gets to be part of it. What she said of Hera, I found an interview of her. It seems like she understands the character. This is a quote from her. What I love about her is that she's such a strong leader and a fighter, and she's also so maternal and nurturing. We often don't see that depicted on screen. We see army generals being these very masculine, hard figures, and Hera has that. But she also has this softness to her. She really wants her crew to be loved and looked after, and at the same time, she's pushing them to be better. That's a pretty good understanding of Hera, I would say.
Yeah, very good. Yeah.
So I want to ask you, is she Hera? Did she pull this off? Because for me, her and Ezra are the two that I was really going, I need more. Because I don't know if they quite got the look right. Hera, to me, in the animation, and it's hard because animation's always got specific things when you're animating alien species. She had bigger eyes. She had a friendlier looking face and a much narrower chin and jawline. And I just found the contacts that they used on Mary Elizabeth here, I found them a little bit too much. Like, they just look like big, bulky blue contacts that didn't look real. It didn't look real enough. So I don't know. And then I'm wondering about her attitude. If you thought she had the right attitude you would expect from Hera after all of these years being part of the Rebellion. I don't know. Give me your feelings on Mary as Hera.
I think they pulled it off really well. I think
okay. From
Ahsoka to Sabine to Hera, I feel like those three look pretty... I think they look closer to the actual translation from animation to live action than most times that we've seen.
Okay.
You know, for example, the fifth brother in Obi-Wan, not really a good transition.
Right.
You know, and in Clone Wars and Rebels, you know, they do take some liberties with the way they're creating those characters. I mean,
yeah.
You know, we know from Clone Wars, I mean, Dooku doesn't look like
Dooku does
in animation, right?
Yeah.
So, there's definitely a difference there. But as far as Hera's a Twi'lek, right? So, Mary Elizabeth looks like a Twi'lek, you know, with... the skin color and the eye color and the Leku, which is her
head tails
basically.
Yeah.
So she did look wise. I feel like she pulled it off really well.
Okay.
Yeah. You know, and I've heard people talking about that with her personality and the way Hera is speaking and acting and in this era. I've heard that also from Ahsoka, that Ahsoka's not quite the same. But it is a different timeline, and it's years later. So we're not season... Even though this may be season 5 of Rebels, this doesn't take place shortly after season 4. I mean,
it's a big time jump.
It's a big time jump. A lot of experience, a lot more experiences that our characters have gone through.
Right.
So it's very much like change. Luke going from Return of the Jedi to Force Awakens. I mean,
to the Last Jedi.
even the Last Jedi. It's like,
yeah.
There's so much time involved and all the experiences that they had between that time, you have to take in a you have to take that into account.
Yeah. You are right. Okay. Yeah, and that's why I feel so. I think just some more time with these guys will sink them in. Mm-hmm. We'll talk about the other characters. I agree with you on some of them, but I think for me, Hera and Ezra, the two that I was like not 100%. Wow, that was really awesome how they did that. But everyone else for sure. And we'll talk about Sabine right now, who's played by Natasha Liu Bordizzo, and she's fairly new. She's not well known yet. She hasn't done. I looked at her credit list, and there's like three or four things on her credits on IMDb. She hasn't done a lot, but I think she did really well. She is a good Sabine. She really brought Sabine to life. Natasha knows a lot of martial arts. She's very active in sports. She's a big time athlete. That's why she was so good in the fight scenes and why she's so fast. Did you notice how quick she was running around after that droid and stuff? She's fast. I thought she did good. I thought she makes a good transition from cartoon to live action.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, Sabine, she looks the part.
Yeah.
She very much could fight like Sabine does, you know, so I think she's, I think she's been really good. Looks great.
Yeah. Yeah, be excited to see. I mean, you guys know I love Sabine. I'm her brother, so it's that. I mean, I worked my story, my own personal story around her, so she's an exciting character to get to see for me here. Let's talk about Morgan Elsbeth, who's played by Diana Lee in Santo. This is truly her big role debut, her big one, because she's been mostly, you look at her IMDb credits, it's like hundreds and hundreds of stunt woman roles. She's been a stunt woman her entire life. For everything under the sun, every TV show, movie, video game, motion capture, whatever, that's what she does, because she grew up around martial arts. Her dad owns a dojo. He's a triple level black belt, whatever the heck. He's massive martial artist. His dad worked, or her dad worked very closely with Bruce Lee, very close work acquaintance, and that's why her middle name is Lee, because Bruce Lee is her godfather. And I thought, that's really freaking cool. That is neat. And now that we know more about her character, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, I'm really, really intrigued and can't wait to see more of this Morgan Elsbeth. Because when she was just the magistrate and Ahsoka went and fought her, I was like, whatever, okay, just some bad guy, some bad politician, and done. Now we find out a lot more, which we'll talk about, and I was like, whoa, okay, I like this character all of a sudden a lot.
Yeah, I'd be curious to know if they knew that when they first brought her into Mandalorian, you know, that they were going to expand her as big as she is, because she's pretty significant now.
That's significant all of a sudden. Yep. Yep. It makes you wonder if they had plans for her way back then, right? Let's move on to the two new characters, Shin Hati and Baylan Skull. So Shin is played by Ivana Sakhno. She's a Ukrainian actress. She hasn't done a lot, but she was part of two big movies. Most recently, The Spy Who Dumped Me. That's that comedy, which is actually pretty funny. If you've never seen it, I thought it was pretty funny. And Pacific Rim Uprising. She was in that, which is a big, big action sci-fi movie about giant robots. It's pretty fun. Mm-hmm. There's not a lot about her and her character. In all her interviews, she's like, nope, I'm not going to talk about it. I don't want to give nothing away. I want you guys to learn and discover the character as you watch the episode. So she's not talking about her, so there really is not a lot to know.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
That's short for saying that I'm not allowed to say anything or Disney will fire me.
Yeah, maybe. Or she doesn't even know. Because talking about Morgan Elsbeth, I was reading an interview with her, and she said she didn't even know her name was Morgan. In the Mandalorian episode, she goes, I was just the magistrate. I didn't have a name.
All right.
And I come on to Ahsoka, and I'm reading dialogue, and I see what? I have a name? She had no idea. So, but Baylan Skull, played by Ray Stevenson, and this, I'm really upset about this. Sadly, he passed away this year in May at just 58 years old, and it's undisclosed what the causes were. 58 is awfully young, Vizla. That's only 8 years away from me.
Yeah.
And we don't know why he died. But Baylan Skull, he was in Clone Wars. He played Clone Wars and Rebels as Gar Saxon. If you remember that character, he was the voice for that guy. He's been in every single Thor movie as Volstagg. He was in all the Divergent movies. He was on the TV show Black Sails, and he was one of the Vikings in Vikings for like 12 episodes. I love this actor. I recognize him, but I don't. I have to go back and find pictures of him as his Viking character, as his Black Sail character, because I watched all that stuff and the Thor movies. But this guy, this Baelin Skull, he is intense. He's got an imposing screen presence. It's so unfortunate that he can't keep going with this character, because just in these two episodes alone, I am completely enthralled with this guy. His acting, his facial expression, the way he carries himself and his voice. Wow, he is amazing in this role.
Yeah, no, I like Ray Stevenson a lot. He was also, I think, the Punisher, right? In the second Punisher movie.
Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, he was... what's his name? The guy from... Walking Dead
the first guy
he was in Dead. The Marvel show, but Thomas Jane was the first, the movie Punisher, and then the second one called Punisher Warzone. Ray Stevenson actually took over.
Oh, and Dolph Lundgren played the part too.
But yeah, he was way back though,
in the 90s. Dolph Lundgren played the Punisher.
But no, I liked Ray Stevenson. I think he's playing this role really well. You know, he's not, you know, he doesn't come off as a Sith, you know, that's going after power. I mean, he is a mercenary, and he is just very sure of himself and skilled at what he's doing. And yeah, I think I'm going to like watching him with this character over the next few weeks. Hopefully, yeah. Ahsoka doesn't kill him too soon.
Too soon, yeah. Well, I wonder what's coming for him, because the actor's gone. Did they write? Did he finish this role, or did they end with him still continuing and now they don't have him anymore?
Right. Yeah, like, we'll have to see.
Oh my gosh. There's just something about him. He is just phenomenal. I think he's got the potential to be one of the greatest Star Wars characters of all time, like top 10. He's just something about him. I'm just sensing there's something really cool about this guy that could make fans love this dark character, you know, like on the level of Darth Maul. Everybody seems to love Darth Maul. I think he can be up there for sure. Pretty cool.
We'll see.
He's got the name Baelin Skull. That's just a name you won't forget.
<It's cool>. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, last up on the list is Ahsoka Tano, played by Rosario Dawson. I can't even list what she's done. She's been in so many movies. She's been in so many TV shows. The Daredevil series on Netflix is one that I remember her from most recently. She's done a ton. Just look her up. You'll recognize her from so many things. It's hard to see anyone else playing the role. It's like what you were saying earlier. She's putting everything she has into bringing Ahsoka to life. She knows how important this character is and how important it is to the fans, and she's doing everything she can to bring her to life, and I cannot think of anyone else doing it. Not even... Ashley Eckstein, who voiced her. I can't even... I would choose Rosario physically over Ashley. It's just amazing.
Yeah. No, Rosario is pretty perfect for it.
Yeah.
Yeah, and you can tell she really, really learned how to use lightsabers. And she's pulling that off really well. No, looks great. She looks great.
Totally does. I mean, this is Ahsoka, older and mature.
Mm-hmm.
All these years. Yeah. Well, let's get into it now. We're going to continue talking about Ahsoka, the main character herself, the namesake of the show. In the opening scroll, it says that she was a Jedi Knight. Did we ever see that graduation from Padawan tonight? I don't think we ever witnessed that, did we? In Clone Wars or Rebels? I thought Padawan.
Yeah, she never became a knight.
So why does the opening scroll say she was a Jedi Knight?
Yeah. I don't know. Because she walked away when she was still a Padawan. Mm-hmm. So.
Unless when Anakin was giving her her lightsabers, maybe he just privately anointed her. You're a knight now. Who knows?
Yeah, I don't think so. But, you know, I mean, she obviously is a she has the skill of a Jedi Knight, you know.
Yeah. Yeah.
I just don't know how you can claim that to be, you know, but yeah, it's hard to say.
Well, that probably ties into my next question, because I feel like, I feel like we're missing some info and some time here. When did Ahsoka rejoin the Rebellion? Because she left, she fled, and we saw in Tales of the Jedi that she was living on that farm planet trying to stay in hiding, and then she faced down that one Inquisitor, and I think didn't Senator Organa contact her or something? Like, we're missing the part where she actually comes back and says, yes, I'm going to help out, and yes, here's my call. Because in this show, she's flying in, she's joining back with the ships, and they're, yep, we got you on our radar, we're tracking you, come on in, Ahsoka, blah, 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 and they it just seems like she's back in it already, and we're missing some time there.
Yeah, so all we know is that she, when she was recruited by Bail, and this is just shortly after the Clone Wars, so, you know, again, that's a long time ago from where we are now.
Yeah.
But when she was recruited, she went by the moniker Fulcrum, which you've heard, they even said Fulcrum again in this episode.
Yeah, which I thought was the name of her ship, but...
No, that's the designation of her personality. Like, a Fulcrum, okay. And Andor was a Fulcrum also. Fulcrums are just basically recruiters. So they're going out there recruiting and finding rebel cells and finding people that are loyal to the rebellion. So that's what she was doing for Bail, was really just kind of finding people. And she was the fulcrum to the Ghost crew, right? She was the one talking to Hera about and providing supplies and leads and things like that. So that's what she was doing. Now, again, there's a big question mark where she is during the original trilogy, because I don't believe that she fought for the rebellion, because why wouldn't she ever be brought up that there's this Jedi helping the rebellion, right?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, this is where they have to retcon it by writing her story away from the original trilogy somehow.
Yes,
she has to have been somewhere else doing something.
Which she could have been out looking for Ezra by herself, I guess. We don't know. We just don't know yet what her timeline is from the end of Rebels to now.
She was on that farm planet the entire time. Like, I don't
know. That farm planet, you're confusing the timelines. That farm planet was after the Clone Wars, so that's way back. That's like 19 years before what we're talking about.
So yeah, original trilogy. Yeah, you're right.
So this is after Rebels, like when she comes back from when Ezra saves her to now, it's like 10-year gap. We just don't know. All we know now is that she somehow at some point trained Sabine, and that fell through, and then she went off and just lived on her ship for a while, going where she's needed.
Maybe
what
Sabine
she
didn't
says.
Fight. Maybe Sabine didn't fight in the war either. Hera
she
did, but Sabine
she
was
didn't. Right, she didn't, because she says in the epilogue, Sabine's the one talking in the epilogue of season 4 of Rebels, and she says that she stayed on Lothal waiting for the Empire to come, but they never came.
Right.
So that's why she wasn't involved in the rebellion against the Empire during the original trilogy. But she mentions how Hera fought in it, how Rex fought in it. So she was not. And she just stayed there. But at some point, Ahsoka had to have come to her and started training her. So that's where we're gonna have to get we're gonna have to get an update to that timeline book, and all this information has to be in there at some point.
Yeah. Oh man. Yep.
But Ahsoka is a fulcrum, basically, and again, she didn't fight during the original trilogy. At least I don't see how she could have. But we don't know where she was either.
Gotcha. Okay. Have you noticed, too, in this series, well, since she came back on Mandalorian and Book of Boba Fett and in this series, She's very serious now. Like, she's not as witty and smart-alecky as she was in the cartoons. So I'm just guessing the situation of the galaxy and whatever she did in this time away where she was, it somehow matured her up quite a bit, and she's definitely a lot more focused. I mean, even in just the way she deals with each situation and the way she harnesses her energy for everything that's happening, like, she seems way more focused than we've ever seen. But she's really serious.
Yeah, I think it's just maturity. In my opinion.
What's happening around her, right? Yeah.
Again, there's a lot of years of experience that we don't know about.
Don't know, yeah.
She's lived through a lot. And at this point, she's, what, she's in her mid-40s, you know, 40s, late 40s. So she's definitely not the teenage, witty kid anymore. You know?
Smart aleck, yeah.
Yeah. Comebacks. Yeah. So, and even the Rebels, I mean, you know, I watched some episodes of her in Rebels again. I mean, she wasn't as witty then either. She felt a lot more serious.
That's true. Yeah, there was a big change there too. Yeah, you're right.
Yeah, because she was more concerned about Anakin and what happened, who Vader was and things like that.
Yeah. Yeah. No, you're right.
A lot of people don't remember. She wasn't in Rebels all that much. Right, she was only in a couple episodes throughout the season two, and that's it. I mean, she wasn't in season three, season four, she wasn't in season one till the very end.
Yeah.
So a lot of people kind of feel like she was part of that series, but she wasn't. It was really about Kanan, Ezra, Hera, Sabine.
Yeah, yeah. No, you're right.
Chopper.
So the big question, which we've kind of already touched on, when did she start training Sabine, and for how long? And then why did she walk away? Why did she stop and walk away, and when did that happen? Do we have any information that we can kind of theorize on that?
I don't have any. I mean, my first question is not when she started, but why? Why did she even decide to start training her in the first place?
Did Sabine a spark of the Force in Sabine?
Yeah, I mean, but again, Jedi, you know, she's not a Jedi master. She's not even a Jedi anymore. Yeah. So why would she even decide to even think about taking on a Padawan? Well, you know,
so when and why? It's two good questions.
I mean, was Ahsoka really starting to think that she wanted to restart the Jedi Order? I doubt it. There's no indication that she felt, you know, once she left that she'd ever want to go back to that.
Maybe the missing time of her getting to know Luke had played a part in that.
But at that point, she never had met Luke yet. There's no way.
We don't know. I mean, when we saw her with Luke on Book of Boba Fett, it seemed like they've known each other for a while, so we don't know what happened there either.
Yeah, but you know, in the original trilogy, Luke never met another Jedi. So it had to have been after Return of the Jedi. And at that point, Sabine and Ahsoka had already started doing this.
Yeah, see? Wow. Okay.
So there's no cross there, you know?
Yeah.
I don't know, you know, there's no answers. Those are questions that hopefully will get answered.
Yeah, you're right. Do you have a guess when they started training? Like, what would make sense to you to fit with what we're seeing?
It would make sense to me that it was during the original trilogy.
Okay.
So when Ezra disappears and Sabine is there waiting for the Empire to come back and retaliate to the Battle of Lothal, Ahsoka then comes and tries to find her and the Ghost crew and discovers that Ezra is gone. Kanan had died. Well, actually, she knew that from World Between Worlds episodes, but then
yeah,
so Hera's already gone to the fight with the rebellion. So it's just Sabine basically on Lothal. I'm guessing my theory would be that she started hanging out with her, waiting for the Empire to come, and decided to train her while they were waiting, basically.
Yeah.
Now, why they stopped and why Ezra or why Ahsoka left her there and just left, that part, I don't know what would have done that.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe the whispers of Thrawn, but then Sabine didn't know that at this point, so Ahsoka would have probably told her that before she left, but something else drew her away, I feel like, and then she started hearing the whispers about Thrawn and then started going down that road by herself.
So we wouldn't know. That's a good guess as to why she stopped and walked away. If that...
The Thrawn thing?
The Thrawn thing is maybe why... I don't know. I guess it depends on how long Ahsoka's been looking for information about Thrawn.
Yeah, I think that kind of came up as she left. I feel like maybe there was just frustration between her and Sabine and the training, and she didn't feel like she was good enough to train her. You know, because she did mention in these episodes, she kept saying how they're not ready. She wasn't ready.
Right.
She wasn't ready. Like, Sabine wasn't ready. And so maybe the frustration there just got to her and said, you know what? I don't want to do this anymore. I'm going to go, you know, kind of thing. I mean, that could be as simple as that.
Yeah, could be. Yeah. That's a good thing. Yeah, for sure.
But I think it was during the original trilogy is when this was happening.
Yeah. Yeah, I could agree with you on that for sure. It's the one storyline that makes sense as to why we never heard of her before.
Yeah, exactly right.
Yeah.
Because I would think that the first encounter that Luke had with Ahsoka after Return of the Jedi would be, where you been? Why didn't you come help me?
Yeah, exactly. You know? Yeah.
But
her reaction is, what? You're Anakin's son?
Yeah, exactly. Like, I mean, there's a whole big conversation. I wish we would have gotten like that conversation, which we haven't gotten yet.
Yeah, hopefully. God, I'd love to see those flashbacks. Well, let me ask you about her two lightsabers. One seems shorter than the other. Have they always been that way? And if so, why? Why is one a little bit shorter?
Yeah, one has always been shorter if you look at Rebels.
That's what I thought. Yeah. So why?
I don't know. You know, the blade is just shorter. And the saber itself, the hilt itself is smaller. So that could be why, but yeah, they're two different sizes.
That's strange, yeah. Not sure. Mm-hmm. Okay. No real answer for that.
Yeah.
How about this one? She can hear Sabine's dreams. When Sabine's in the hospital there and she's dreaming before she wakes up, Ahsoka can hear what she's dreaming about. Now, is that a normal Jedi power? Or is that just one that Ahsoka learns? Because I've realized that some Jedi learn abilities that other Jedi just don't have. They seem like it'd be very specific things that some Jedi get. So is this one for Ahsoka, or is that something all Jedi can do? Listen into somebody's dreams.
I think most Jedi have the telepathy type of ability, you know, to be able to read one's mind or sense what they're feeling or saying.
Yeah.
I think that's all that is. I mean, even if she was being asleep or awake, I think she can read what she's thinking and have that conversation in a sense, like she did with Grogu. Right, Grogu didn't speak anything, but she was able to communicate with him.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, that's okay. I just wondered if Ahsoka was maybe stronger in that ability than most Jedi. Like,
I mean,
I know there's this Jedi mind trick, but we haven't seen all of them read minds and read feelings. So,
well, Yoda does a lot of that. You know, remember?
Yeah.
He was able to read Luke's thoughts and.
Yeah. Vader too. Your thoughts betray you. And,
correct.
Yeah.
Okay. But Ahsoka seems very skilled in a lot of powers.
She does. Yeah. Well, like this next one, she can hear through the Force, which you brought this up earlier. I said I'm going to come around to again. The sounds of the past when she's at specific locations. Now, is that a common Jedi power? And when did she learn that? Like, she was at the at the tower, at Ezra's tower, and she was listening in to what happened to Sabine. And you called it Force Echoes.
It's a Force Echo. Yeah. Again, that's from the game, Jedi Fallen Order.
So is this the first time in live action we've seen it?
That's the first time I've seen it. Yeah. In the game, you play as Cal Kestis, you know, a Jedi. Again, never became a knight. He was a Padawan when Order 66 happened.
Yeah.
But during the game, you come across these like glowing areas and you can go up to it and sense, you know, go up to it and do a Force Echo, and then you can sense and hear what happened in that scene years, thousands of years, whatever, hundreds of thousands of years before in the past. So,
right.
When she was doing that with her hand, and, you know, I'm like, whoa, she's doing a Force Echo. This is really awesome. So,
cool.
So yeah, it's definitely a power we don't really see much of. I mean, I feel like Yoda would probably be able to do it. I just don't see him having, he never really had a time to do it, but, mm-hmm. but yeah, it's a way for Jedi to get a sense of what happened.
So where's she learning all these abilities? She left Anakin. I don't know. She wasn't finished being trained.
I don't know. I mean, unless she came across some holocrons or, you know, that's a very good question. And, you know, she might have been trained. You know, she's probably been introduced to these things as she was a Padawan. You know, even a youngling with Yoda. She probably was introduced to a lot of these things, but...
Yeah,
it's been upon herself to really develop them and hone them, which has been pretty impressive.
Okay. Yeah, it is. I mean, she's becoming one of the more powerful Jedi that we've ever seen.
The most powerful, almost. Yeah, I mean, it's arguably maybe. She could be the most powerful Jedi at this time.
Yeah. She's the one who's lived through all of this stuff.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I tell you, I thought for sure when Hera brought up Anakin, when they were talking about, you know, the map and all that kind of stuff, and Ahsoka paused, I thought for sure, well, Ahsoka paused and was thinking we were going to get a flashback right then. I thought, oh my God, it's coming. And then nothing. Like, aw. It was the perfect opportunity. She brought up Anakin. They talked about your old master, yada, yada. Perfect opportunity to bring in a flashback. Nothing.
Yeah, I kind of got the sense that we were going to see a flashback in this sometime in this first two episodes, but
yeah,
it didn't come. I think there's a rumor out there that Anakin. I think what I read that there's a rumor that Anakin shows up in episode 5.
Oh, already? Yeah, okay.
Yeah,
God, that's more than halfway already.
Jeez. I know.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we'll see.
Ah. Well, I kind of like what you're talking about being the most powerful. Just talking about her power set. They've gotten better and better, and her skills are top-notch. Like, she's no match for anybody that she faces anymore. And I think that's because, she seems so focused and in control. More so than we've ever seen her. Like, she just seems so grounded and settled in and just uses the Force in complete control. Like, this is not the Ahsoka we've seen before.
No. No, and as of right now, the fighting that we've seen her do, you know, against these droids and you know, this Inquisitor or whatever, it doesn't seem like she's even putting any effort into it. It's
she almost even has a smirk sometimes. Mm-hmm. She's like, oh yeah, you can have your spinny lightsaber, whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Very skilled.
Yeah, you're right. Very confident too, yeah. I don't know. Something about her. I hope we get a bit of that backstory too. Like, what has changed in her to be like this? Why is she,
right.
You know, is is Anakin the Force Ghost training her and we just don't know? Like,
oh, yeah, I don't know. That'd be tough.
Oh, man. Well, we find out that we pretty much seen through these two episodes and from the trailers, like, she's basically got two missions. Find Thrawn. And in searching for Thrawn, maybe we can find Ezra as well. That seems to be the brunt of Ahsoka's story for now.
Prevent the war. prevent another war and hopefully find Ezra while you're doing it. Yep.
Okay. Let's move on to Morgan Elsbeth, because this is the part I wanted to come back around to. This is what made me get so excited and suddenly have a huge investment in this character. They drop in this episode that she is a night sister of Dathomir. We never knew that from her Mandalorian. Like, nothing came up. I was like, holy crap, what a surprise. It just jumped her interest of characters to me to the top tier, top five. I want to know more about Morgan Elsbeth. She's the sister of Dathomir. Did you see that coming?
Did not see that coming. But again, you want to talk about parallels from the game, because the game, you go to Dathomir and you learn a lot more about the Night Sisters.
Okay.
So
maybe Filoni likes those games.
It's pretty interesting. I'm telling you, it's pretty interesting. Because there's a woman named Marin that becomes a major character in Jedi Fallen Order, and she actually becomes an ally. So, yeah, there's a lot of Dathomir and a lot of Night Sisters.
I loved in the Star Wars Clone Wars and stuff, I loved the Sisters of Dathomir, that whole storyline with Asajj Ventress. You guys know Asajj is my favorite female Star Wars character of all time. I loved her entire storyline, her just everything she went through, try to save my sisters, try to help my sisters, lost all my sisters, try to kill Maul, and just everything that she went through. And then you read the book that she's in, the Dark Apprentice, and you find out even more about Asajj.
Dark Disciple.
Dark Disciple. And you find out her story even more in depth there. Like, I love that character so much. And the fact that they just bring this Morgan into, I was like, oh my God, it's so close. That's as close as we're going to get to having a live action Asajj, is having Morgan as a Night Sister. But it makes me wonder, would she have known Asajj Ventress, do you think? Could that be possible? Could we get even a name drop of Asajj from Morgan? I don't know why you would, but
yeah,
timeline wise, could she have known her?
Yeah, I think she could have known her. It seems like Morgan's a little older. Seems a little older in age.
She looks 50s to me. 50,
yeah. So she would have had to have been living during the Clone Wars, because that's when Asajj was around. So it's possible. It's definitely possible.
Can you imagine if she's like, yeah, my sister Asajj, yada, yada, yada. Like, whoa, there it is. That'd be pretty cool. Even just to get a flashback and see Asajj in live action, I wouldn't care. I would love it. I got to see her in live action.
I'd love to see Asajj in a live action, yes.
Oh, man. So how powerful is she in Witch Arts? Do you have any idea? Like, we've got different levels of Jedi, different levels of Sith. Is there the same thing with the Night Witches? Do they have higher levels, like you're a top tier witch and you're part of their little enclave? Or because a lot of the sisters, there seemed to be a ton of them when we saw those episodes. Right, we're just speculating right now because we don't really know. We just found out Morgan is a Night Sister, so, and we saw her using her magic a little bit here. It's very similar to Jedi power. She can manipulate and do things without touching them. Where do you think she is as a Night Sister? Because she, the way she talked about it, sounded like, yeah, my descendants, like from long time ago. Like, it doesn't seem like there's any Night Sisters around, and people are surprised that she's here. Like, it seems like they're all wiped out or something.
Yeah, well, the Night Sisters were... Yeah, see, I can't fully remember, but again, the game, Jedi Fallen Order, I keep referencing, but...
Hey, that's canon, so...
Dathomir and the Night Sisters, a lot of that history is explained of what happened to them in that game. And again, that was about 5 years after the Clone Wars. Mm-hmm. So there is a lot of story there. And yes, there aren't that many Night Sisters left after the whole Clone Wars. And, you know, because there was a big war that happened on Dathomir during the Clone Wars. And of course, Dooku, you know, was Mother Talzin was the head of the Night Sisters. And I believe, if I remember correct, Dooku betrayed her in a sense and tried to have her killed, and that's what drove Asajj away from Dooku,
right,
and things like that. So, and end up, you know, becoming more of a mercenary in a sense than in a bounty hunter versus a Night Sister.
Yeah.
But it's all magic. It's, you know, they do tap into the dark side. You know, they are kind of dark side wielders in a sense, but they're more of the magic side of it, right?
Mystical.
Yeah.
So
like a witch. They're witches, basically. You know,
yeah.
Star Wars witches, in a sense. So.
So she's probably powerful. We just haven't seen the extent of her ability yet.
Yeah, she's probably, depending on how much she has been training with it and using it.
Because we didn't see it in Mandalorian when she fought Ahsoka. She didn't. She just fought with a Beskar staff. She didn't use any witch abilities. So
I don't know if they knew at the time that she was going to be a Night Sister.
That's what I wonder. Yeah, if they changed that. So
yeah.
Huh.
Yeah.
Still. Made her pretty darn interesting all of a sudden.
It is very interesting.
For sure.
Yes.
So, the witches of Dathomir, what was their purpose again? Like, why were they the witches? Why was there this enclave? I'm trying to remember from the Clone Wars what the Night Sisters were all about, because they would help certain people, and I remember what they had a whole setup when Asajj was trying to help her dead sisters and help them pass on and went over. They had this huge elaborate setup to allow them to do that, and I'm just trying to remember what their whole, I don't know, can you give us a nutshell version of what the Night Sisters were all about?
Well, I mean, I guess it's interesting because it's still pretty broad as far as broadness of it, how long they've been around. I mean, we're just now kind of learning that stuff, you know. Again, I think the deepest that we've gone into them is the video game, because in the Clone Wars, how they're portrayed in the Clone Wars, where there are these dark warriors, they kind of lived on themselves, and they were assassins. You know, they would be hired to go, you know, infiltrate and kill people and things like that. And their brothers, in a sense, right? They had Night Brothers, which were the Zabrak, which was Darth Maul. So the men were trained as warriors, like Savage Opress, which was Darth Maul's brother. But Maul was recruited, obviously, through Mother Talzin by Dooku to be, by Palpatine to be the next apprentice to Darth Sidious, right? So there's kind of a, you know, between Sith and Night Sister, there was this, obviously, this agreement in a sense that they would, you know, work together in a sense, I guess, to further each other's agendas. But, you know, they by far didn't have, at least I don't think so, they didn't have any kind of representation in the Republic or anything like that. They kind of were just on their own and lived on this planet to you know, to be their own little society of mystical witches, but of course, again, we're recruited to do things around the galaxy by people. So but as Asajj got recruited to fight along with Dooku and the Clone Wars, you know, the war eventually made its way to Dathomir, and there were a lot of Night Sisters that got killed during that time.
Yeah. It's a cool story. I mean, I'll have to maybe play the game so I can learn a little bit more about them, because I just know from the book and from the Clone Wars, so, and I'm fascinated. Yeah.
Yeah, there hasn't been a lot, you know, where they came from, why they started, you know. They just didn't, they weren't part of the Republic in a sense, you know, or part of the Empire.
Yeah. Well, Morgan, continuing to talk about her, she seems to know a lot. Like, She knew the map ball is from an ancient people from another galaxy. And we're going to start getting into all of this because this stuff is just blowing me away. But how would she know that? How would she know where this map ball is from? Is it her witch powers that can she read? Or, like, read from the map that I know where this is from? Or does do you think maybe she has contact with this ancient people from another galaxy? Because that there's a lot of information dropped here, stuff that we never thought was possible yet in Star Wars. And I got a lot of questions for you. But right now, like, how would she know that this map ball is from another galaxy? I guess.
Yeah, you know, I don't know. Part of me feels like there's so many big questions I have about the whole map thing, because
yeah, well, we're gonna get more into it here. I got those points coming up. So
yeah, I don't know. Does she? You know, is that? It can't be her. Her globe, because she would be able to know how to open it. But I feel like she doesn't know how to open it, or where it even goes.
She needed Sabine to figure it out.
Yes, and she needed Balin to find where to even put it.
Yeah.
Because I guess, yeah, Sabine can open it, but then I guess you can take it to the kind of Stonehenge place and the map opens there by itself too. I don't know. She kind of used magic. She used magic, it looked like, to open it, to activate it. So, yeah. So part of me is like, she made this thing, but then it doesn't seem like she made this thing. And then who's telling her that Thrawn wants to come back? Because I don't believe Thrawn's. It's hard for me to believe Thrawn's doing that.
Well, let's get into all that, because, yeah, there's a lot of big questions here. So one of them I want to ask you, maybe a simple one. Has Star Wars ever gone to another galaxy? Do they know how to travel between them, or is this something new? Because I remember at the end of Empire Strikes Back, when we see Luke and Leia watching Chewie and Lando fly away, the very last shot, we get that big shot of the Millennium Falcon flying. They're above, and it looks like a spiral galaxy, Milky Way, below them as the Millennium Falcon's flying down and towards it. That's the shot that we're looking at. So I thought, where are they? Are they in, like, the space between galaxies? If you remember that clip, are they in the space between galaxies? So has Star Wars ever gone from galaxy to galaxy? I didn't know they did.
No, I don't think they have not. I don't believe they have not. I don't think there's any really record of travel outside of their own galaxy, because I don't know how you plug that in a navicomputer, because how does the navicomputer know the layout of the universe, you know, without studying it?
Yeah.
So,
because I mean, they have the core, the inner ring, the outer ring, the outer core, the lost worlds, the wild space. I mean, that's all within their same galaxy.
It's all in the same galaxy. Unknown regions. Yeah. They have unknown regions in their own galaxy. They haven't explored yet. So
that tells me, they've never been out. But so then how do you explain that shot at the end of Empire then?
I don't think that's a galaxy. I don't think that's a galaxy. I think it could be just a cluster. A cluster of planets.
Yeah.
Well,
I mean, back then, they weren't thinking this far ahead that this stuff would come up. It just looked, it was just a cool space shot to have back then, really. But anyway, okay. So they've never traveled across the galaxy before.
Because you got to be, so if that's their galaxy, if you're saying that that's a different galaxy or that's the Star Wars galaxy, either way, they've got to be millions of light years away to see a galaxy that small.
Exactly. That's why I don't think it's a crazy shot.
That's why I don't think it's a galaxy. It's like an internal cluster of stuff. You know,
unless they're in their own galaxy looking at the next galaxy that's super close by. Like, I have no idea.
Yeah, it could be. Yeah, could be the edge of their own galaxy, and then that's just a distant galaxy. Maybe, I don't know.
Yeah, it could have just been a cool shot. It probably meant nothing. Hey, that's a cool shot. We're Star Wars. We're in space. Nobody's done this before. Let's show this. I guess that's all it probably was. So Okay, so never traveled to another galaxy. Morgan says the map was designed by these ancient people. So my question is, okay, if this map ball was designed by this ancient people in another galaxy, did they come all this way to deliver it? Or did they send it here? Or are they working with Thrawn in their galaxy and he sent it here to have Morgan come find him? Because all three of those questions, I still want to ask, why was it buried in the temple under all those puzzles and encased in mud, basically? How did this thing get here? That's my question. If it's from an ancient people in another galaxy, how did it get to where we see it?
So she said the map was from?
Yeah.
Okay.
She said that she when she was, Balin was asking her, she was holding the thing up, and she says, this is from an ancient people in another galaxy.
Oh, I thought she meant the structure was, not the map. Yeah.
Oh, I think she's referring to Balin the map itself.
Like, because Balin said, you know, this isn't a Jedi area, and like Jedi didn't build this. She said, no, people from a ancient galaxy built this.
Even still then, ball or the place that they're standing in, the ancient people were here from another galaxy?
Yeah, that's what it seems like. And that's why it comes back to, well, who's actually talking to her? It seems like it's more about these other right now. Could she be referring to the Chiss? She could be referring to the Chiss, which is Thrawn's species. So that's possible, because now the problem is they're from, I believe the Chiss ascendancy is actually from the unknown regions, which is still in the same galaxy. It's not from a distant galaxy. So I don't think it's the Chiss. So it's something else. I think it might be something. Now, you know, there's possibly rumors. The only civilization we know outside of this galaxy is the Hussein Vong, which is,
who's that?
So in the new I think it's called the New Jedi Order series, the books that happen, you know, in Legends now. But in that book series, Luke comes across a species called the Hussein Vong, and they are from a different galaxy and come and start a war. It's called the Hussein Vong War, and they are immune to force powers. Like, you can't use your force powers against them. So
crazy.
And you know, I believe during this battle, during this war, that's when Chewbacca gets killed, you know. So anyway, I don't know. I didn't read that whole series. All I know is a little bit of the Cliff Notes, but that is in my Star Wars knowledge, Filoni was going to introduce them in the Clone Wars in some of those episodes that never get made. So this may now be his way of bringing them into this series, which would be pretty incredible.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people want them to be canon.
I had never heard of it. That's insane. So, okay, that might give us some answers then as to what these ancient people from another galaxy are. Yeah. Again, it's this map thing, though. My sticking point is, we know how Thrawn got taken away and disappeared. Why is there a map of that? I don't understand. Why is there a map when you stick it on this thing and it shoots a beam right to the exact point where Thrawn is supposed to be? Why is there that? Like, that's my question. Is Thrawn working with this ancient people and they created this map and he had it sent back to them for Morgan to find, because Morgan was looking for it and now she found it, and now she knows where Thrawn is, and now she's building her big ship and she's going to go find him. Like, I have a feeling Thrawn did something to get that map made to let her know, this is where I am. That's the only conclusion I have of this, because the map makes no sense as to why it exists unless Thrawn had it made to get somebody to come rescue him.
Yeah, or, you know, the only thing I can put together right now possibly is that, you know, when Ezra and Thrawn hyperspace to this distant galaxy, that they came across, let's just say, this other species, which could be the Husen Vong, and now they are prisoners to them, and the Vong need a way to, you know, come back to this galaxy, and so they're in a way kind of manipulating their way in by using Morgan, because they are, you know, they are, at least again, they're known to be force immune in a sense, but yeah, and I don't think they were force sensitive, but they're kind of force immune, so I don't know how they're communicating with Morgan in a sense, but somehow they are. And maybe this map already existed in a sense, and it's not pointing to where Thrawn is. It's, well, it is now, but it's pointing to where this civilization was, and maybe they were here at this point. Maybe they built this stuff. Maybe the Night Sisters have some connection to them, and that's where we're going with this. That's a far stretch, I know, but you know.
But it could be part of that magical, mystical terrain for sure. But she does say, Thrawn is calling to me, and you hear somebody say, Morgan.
Yeah, yeah.
So, if she thinks it's Thrawn talking to her, whether it's Thrawn himself or it's whatever these other species are, these other species are able to contact her, they're maybe just sending a message, of Thrawn's voice to her, so she thinks it is Thrawn, and this is why she gets. I don't know. I mean, obviously, this is the story. We're going to find out more, but. Oof. I know Baylan called this area that we're talking about, the Stonehenge looking thing, they call it the reflex point on Cetos. So Cetos is the planet that they're on, but he calls it the reflex point. And I'm guessing that Stonehenge like structure, that's where Morgan places the ball and it levitates and then lights up the entire area with a 3D map. I'm guessing that that reflex point is just that mechanism that helps display the map. It basically shows them in a 3D environment. Phew, there's the galaxy. There, that's where you got to go. That's what this, that's what Stonehenge was always known to be or speculated to be, is some type of connection to the stars.
Right.
So that's why this reminded me of that.
Yeah. It's very, very interesting that they kind of use like a Stonehenge type area, because you said, it's very much a mystery of how that was built and where it came from, and this is kind of the same way. But again, how all of a sudden does that map work with that area?
It looks like they were a matching set. Yeah.
That's why I just don't. It's right now, it's just hard for me to follow how this has anything to do with Thrawn.
Exactly. I mean, look at where the map was buried. It was buried underground in an ancient temple encased in mud that you needed to solve a puzzle to get to. Why?
Yeah. Again, I think this is kind of Morgan getting manipulated. But they have, but I think they have Thrawn. And I'm probably gonna. Right now. I'm kind of gonna go with that. It's the Vong. Unless he introduces a whole like other species. This is the only species we know of that's outside of this galaxy.
Okay.
In Legends, in a way.
It's a possibility. Well, let's talk about how she's going to get there, because the Eye of Sion is this massive ship that she's building that's got multiple hyperdrives. I think I saw 6 hyperdrives. I paused it to look. I think I count 6 around this ring, and I think she needs that many hyperdrives to be able to travel that far and within a short enough amount of time that they don't all die of old age on the journey to get to the other galaxy to get to Thrawn. Because he's calling to her. I mean, that's what that ship is. I can't assume it's for anything else, but it's a ship to travel between galaxies. the Eye of Sion. I think it's
a hyperspace ring, right?
Similar to the one Obi-Wan had, right?
Correct.
For his little ship.
So if you think about the size of it,
yeah,
it probably fits a Star Destroyer.
Okay.
And the Star Destroyer is gonna, which is probably his Star Destroyer, Chimera.
The Chimera is gonna jump over there.
That's kind of what I'm thinking. Yes. Hmm.
Yeah. So we talked about how he's calling to her. We're not really sure. And that ship, like I said, it looks like a massive version of little Obi-Wan's hyper ring that he used in the Clone Wars and in the prequel movies. He used it.
Right.
You know, his little arrowhead dart ship attached to it, and the whole ring would fly off. And then when it got to its destination, he would unattach from it and fly down to the planet. The ring just stayed there. But here's the bridge that we see Morgan on when she's staring out the window and looking at it. It's the exact same bridge that we also see Thrawn walk into in the trailer. So we know that she gets to him. And that's probably the shot that we get when he, whenever it happens, when they finally got to him, they finally rescue him, and he's all cleaned up or whatever, because we see him in his white Thrawn outfit, he walks onto the bridge of that ship. And it's the same one that we see her standing on here. So It's pretty cool.
Probably safe to say that, yeah, she gets to him. Yeah.
She gets to him, and that's what brings him back. Yeah, so how long until they get to them? Is this an all-season thing or next episode thing? She said this is the last hyperdrive. The ship's complete.
It's getting installed. So I think it's, You know, there's a scene where Bail and Ahsoka are fighting in that Stonehenge area, which I think could be this next episode. Because they already tracked to where they are. So.
Yep.
Yeah.
Probably
so
right there.
I think it'll probably be mid season, you know, episode five or six or so that we get Thrawn in here.
Right. Okay. Mid season, eh? All right.
Mm-hmm.
So what this is setting up, it's a race to the other galaxy. They're going to go rescue Thrawn. Ahsoka wants to go get Thrawn. And at the same time, she wants to also get Ezra and hope to find Ezra. So I got two questions here. How will Ahsoka and Sabine travel that distance to the other galaxy? They're not building a super hyperdrive. So how are they going to follow them to get there? Or how are they going to get there on their own? And will they find Ezra out there as well? Is that where Ezra is?
Well, you got to think that he's where Thrawn is, so probably so. Mm-hmm. And no, I don't know how they get there without this thing, without this hyperspace ring. Because ship can get there.
Yeah.
So they probably hitch a ride, maybe. You know.
Yeah, that's what I wonder. Sneak aboard.
They get on a board and they are there when they turn this thing on.
Yeah. I don't know.
Yeah,
I don't know, man, but it's interesting.
It's very interesting.
There's a lot of setup happening, and I got no answers and hardly any theories about how a lot of this is going to happen.
Right.
Yeah. Okay, let's talk about Baylan, Skull, and Shin Hati, surviving Jedi that have turned to mercenaries. And based on that line, is Morgan paying them to work for her, since she says something, or he said something about you're paying me, he said some offhanded comment about paying him money, or is she in command of them somehow? What do you think is going on there?
She is paying them.
She's just paying them. So if they stop paying, or if she stopped paying them, they won't do what she wants.
Yeah. No, they're in it for the money right now.
Yeah. Okay.
But there is something bigger that he kind of refers to, but. You know, he's only there doing what she wants because she's paying him.
She's paying him. Right. Do you think Baylan knows Ahsoka? Because when he springs her from the prison, he asks Morgan, who is this Jedi that we're after? And she says, it's Ahsoka. Or she says, Ahsoka Tano. And he raises an eyebrow. And I don't know how to read that. Does he know her or does he go, huh? I never heard of her. What do you think his reaction is to hearing the name?
Yeah, I think he knows who she is. Yeah, because we've kind of seen in the trailer too, where he says, You know, I knew Anakin. I knew your master, Anakin.
That's right. I forgot about that. You're right.
Yeah.
So to hear her name drop, that was probably more surprised. Oh,
he's probably surprised. Yeah, that she's still alive.
Okay. But he's not telling Morgan that he knows her.
No, not yet.
And this is the interesting point. Near the end of the episode, he questioned, why do I have to kill Ahsoka? He doesn't want to kill her because he says it would be a waste because there's so few Jedi left alive. It would be a waste to kill Ahsoka. So do we see him turning to help Ahsoka in the end? Do we see him turning maybe just enough to not let her die? Because he says, he argues, why do I have to kill her? That's a waste. It's a waste of the Jedi. There's hardly any of us left. Because it seems to me that he's of the belief that Jedi, no matter what side they're on, should kind of stick together at this point in time because there's not many of them left.
Yeah, I don't know. That's hard to say because I think they still have to explain the whole red or orange sabers, whatever people want to call them, because they're not the traditional colors, right? So they are tapping into the dark side, but they're not Sith. So
no.
So you got to think that he probably, you know, doesn't necessarily want to kill her, but you know, if he's getting paid to do her bidding, he's got to follow through with it.
I don't know. I think because he's not fully Sith, and because he knows Anakin, I just think there's something there that they're going to end up working together eventually in the end, or he's just going to, Ahsoka's going to be in trouble, and he's going to come in and be the one that stops her from dying, and then he's just going to move on, or he sacrifices himself, and that's why he dies. There's something there. The reason he argued, why do I have to kill her? That means something to me. I think that's going to carry on and come up again later.
Interesting.
So Shin, when she's facing Sabine in battle, did you notice, like, when Sabine draws her lightsaber, Shin kind of stands back and looks at her, and she's just assessing her for a few moments? I wonder if that's when she's reading her through the Force and kind of assessing her strength and the level of power that Sabine has. Because she kind of assesses her, and then she kind of gets a little half smirk on the one side, like, oh, you're nothing.
Yeah.
Bring it. Is that what you felt there too?
That's what I felt. Yeah, I felt like she's realizes that Sabine doesn't wield the Force, just the lightsaber.
Mm-hmm. So you think she was just toying with her there?
I think.
Or did Sabine put up a decent fight?
I think Sabine knows how to use the lightsaber. She's just not as powerful.
Right. Because Shin didn't really use any Force powers on in the fight. She just beat her hand to hand. After the fight, I should say the fight ends with Shin stabbing Sabine through with the lightsaber. That was the shocking spot I didn't expect. I mean, we obviously know we're not going to lose Sabine in the first episode, but I wasn't expecting her to get cut down, but it kind of makes sense. She didn't get hit in a vital spot, really. But for the story, we have to see Sabine overcome this weakness of not being fully trained, not having full use of the Force, and we have to, I think, over the course of the series, watch her grow and get better. Then she'll face off against Shin again and either be able to stand toe-to-toe with her or be able to defeat her. I think this is the, you know, the fall and rise again of Sabine's hero story.
Yeah, I think we are going to see her grow, and I think she's actually going to become more, I have this feeling she's going to become more Force sensitive. I think she has to a little bit.
Yeah, I have a feeling it's something along the line of her just, she's not open to it. She's just not able to open herself up to it.
Yeah.
Yeah,
I think that's because, you know, I keep seeing in these TV spots, you know, advertising the show, some of them had the text in there that says, a new Jedi will rise, right?
You're right, yeah.
So I think that actually could be referring to Sabine, not necessarily Ahsoka. Because Ahsoka's not a new Jedi.
No, she's not new. She already was one.
Right.
So
I think this is going to show Ahsoka working with a Sabine and trying to, you know, get her back.
So we got Luke, Grogu, Ahsoka, Rey, and now Sabine. Those are our Jedi right now.
Well, Rey's not even born yet.
No, but I'm in having new Jedi in our storylines.
Yeah. Well, Ben Solo.
Yeah, Ben Solo. Yeah, you're right. So there's something cool that I'm going to give credit to Parashand. She posted this on her Facebook page, and then I saw a bunch of other people talking about it, and someone even goes into it on YouTube channel about Balin Skull and Shin Hati. In Norse mythology, that's Vikings, Skull, meaning treachery or mockery, is a wolf that, according to some stories, likes to chase the sun, personified as a goddess riding her chariot across the sky. Hati is another Norse legend that likes to chase the moon during the night. So you have Skull chasing the sun during the day and Hati chasing the moon during the night. So how cool is it that our two characters are Balin Skull and Shin Hati? There's something in there about, I don't remember what I read, there's something in there about Floney or somebody loving Norse mythology, and that they're really trying to work in very sneakily a lot of the Norse beliefs into Star Wars and the characters and stuff. And there's a perfect example right there. Skull and Hati, sun chaser, moon chaser. Kind of cool.
That's very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's nice.
All right, so the last point I got here on our show for the bounties is an interesting one. We get this new masked inquisitor looking dude who fights Ahsoka, and when we saw him, we all thought, oh, an inquisitor? What? There's one alive still in this time period? Like, I thought they're all gone. What's an inquisitor doing here? There's still one left, because he had the red lightsaber. He had that dual disc blade handle thing with the dual lightsabers come out of it. And it turns out his name is Marok. Because Balin actually says, Marok will handle it. Don't worry. He can take this mission on. But who is he? Because he has force powers. We see him call his saber back after he throws it at Ahsoka, like a mile away. And you see him force pull it back to himself when he jumps on the ship. But who does he work for? Because he seems to be under the command of Balin.
Yeah, I think he's with... Well, you know, I don't know. I kind of feel like they're all working for Morgan. Because Balin is more or less... I don't know if I've seen... It doesn't seem like Balin is telling Marok what to do. Just... I know he says, Shin, go with Marok. You know, to Corellia.
Yeah.
So it seems like Morgan has recruited Marok. But the whole thing about him is, it's... Having an Inquisitor at this time is a little weird.
Kind of out of nowhere, right?
Yeah. Because the Inquisitors were basically put out of business even before the original trilogy came about.
Yeah. So we're way ahead of that time now, and here this guy shows up, and
correct.
It's crazy.
Yes.
Now, I want to ask you what you think his story is, because I found a theory on YouTube. I listened to a couple. There's a few things out there people were speculating, but I found this one from this girl, I can't remember what she called herself, and she kind of broke it down, and this blew me away. If there's even a slight possibility of this, the story capabilities or this the places that the story could go if he is this character could blow us away, and I wouldn't put it past Dave Filoni to come up with something like this. But apparently, and you know this better than me, there was, I think in the comic books or somewhere in the storylines, Vader took on another apprentice after he became Vader, and his name was Galen Marok.
Marek.
And from what I read about him, Marek was just a young Padawan when Anakin went to attack the Jedi Temple, which we've seen clips of, and kill everybody. He found one specially gifted youngling, and he decided to save him and take him under his wing and then raise him as his own and train him. And that guy's name was Galen Marek. And being Vader's apprentice, I don't know the timeline and where he comes from and why he's been gone and why he's showing up now, but imagine this. Let me put it in this perspective. We have Anakin's apprentice in Ahsoka, and now she's facing off against Vader's apprentice in Marek. How crazy is that to think? A light side apprentice, a dark side apprentice, both by the same individual, are now facing off against each other.
Yeah, that's interesting. We'd have to get a pretty good backstory on Marek to know that.
Well, because do you know who Galen Marek is? Like, tell me your knowledge.
Yeah,
of
and
the
it's
character.
It's Galen Marek. It's
Marek.
It was Merrick.
Okay, so it's a little bit of play on his
Galen
name there.
Galen Marek, and he was the son of two Jedi that went hidden after the fall of the Republic.
Okay.
So, and these are from the video games, The Force Unleashed. So they're not canon, obviously.
Yeah.
So Vader does find Galen and trains him as an apprentice. Calls him Starkiller. He then goes by the name Starkiller.
Starkiller, right. Yeah, I remember seeing that.
And in the games, which was pretty awesome, it ends up being... Galen ends up being the reason why the rebellion is formed. So, back then, it was an interesting canon storyline that you thought of at the time was, oh, he's the one up... Because he's the one that brought Bail, brought Leia, and this guy named Gar Bill Bliss... He brought them all together to form the Rebel Alliance because he turned against Vader to join the Rebellion in a sense. And it was his sacrifice that kind of pushed the Rebellion into this charge to take over. So that was an interesting storyline that obviously is not canon anymore. But so yes, could this be Starkiller? I guess. But again... there's no way in my mind that storyline could be canonized. I mean, a version of it can probably come about, but
a version of it they could be, because they've drawn on so much stuff before that was never canon, and they're like, oh, we like that little aspect,
sure,
let's throw it in our show now, and they've so they could be reworking the idea.
Yeah, I like the theory. There's two other theories. I like the theory that I've heard since come about online, but actually Hannah came to me with a theory that she believes that this is actually Barriss Offee.
I don't know who that is.
So at the end of season 5 of the Clone Wars, when Ahsoka gets framed and then ultimately walks away from the Jedi Order,
yeah,
Barriss is the one that frames her. She's a Padawan of Luminari.
Yo, yeah, okay, yeah.
So,
because we never really see what happens to her. She's just
we don't know what happens to her.
Yeah,
she gets imprisoned, but then after the fall of the Empire or the fall of the Republic, and the Empire takes over, I'm sure she escaped. So we have no idea where she is. And so, how interesting would it be that Ahsoka is now fighting the very person that caused her to leave the Jedi Order?
That's pretty fascinating as well. But did they not refer to Marek as male? Or
okay.
Did they just say...
So they do call him he.
Yeah.
But they may not know what his gender is.
Right.
And if you go to Star Wars databank online, StarWars.com, this is all it says about Marek. It says Marek. It says, once an inquisitor hunting Jedi for the Empire, the mysterious Marek now works as a mercenary hired by Morgan Elsbeth to carry out dark deeds. Fully encased in battered battle armor, the warrior still carries a red double-bladed saber with a circular hilt. So it doesn't say he still or she still.
It says the warrior.
It says the warrior. So I think it's, I think they're hiding the fact that it could be he or she.
Well, that's even more information I didn't know right there in that one paragraph. So,
there's that theory. And then the other theory I'm reading online, which I don't believe this at all, but a lot of people are theorizing that it's a brainwashed Ezra.
I think I saw some about that.
Yeah.
That. Yeah. I don't. That one.
If they're looking for Ezra, I wouldn't think it would all of a sudden be him.
They wouldn't just have him right there. I mean, that would. Oh, I think that would be upsetting. That'd be a little too cheap.
Yeah.
To have him right there. But maybe they're looking for the emotional slap in the face. It's Ezra! And, you know, he's been against them the whole time.
Yeah. But then there's a whole bunch of people saying, look, everybody's doing what they normally do, right? They're reaching that at somebody that ultimately may not be anybody.
Might not be anybody, yeah.
But I just can't imagine. I just don't know why he would be in, why that person would be there.
Well, he even got his own character poster, and only the major players get their own character poster.
I know.
On StarWars.com. So, and you know what he reminded me of? Like when I saw him, and you see his name, and you see the way he looks like Snake Eyes from G.I. Joe.
Yeah. Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Like, it's pretty absolutely much Snake Eyes.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know. I like the theory of him being Vader's apprentice. If they work that in, that to me is my favorite story. That would be pretty spectacular.
That would be pretty interesting, yeah.
Dark apprentice versus light apprentice, all from the same master. That would be pretty cool.
Well, and it's possible because Barriss, again, was evil in a sense. That it's very likely she became an Inquisitor.
Yeah, that's true.
So technically she was trained by Vader at the time then, because Vader trained all the Inquisitors.
Right.
So,
Barriss, again, this is how many years ago since the Inquisitors should have been gone? So where'd this one come from?
Well, yeah, but I mean, he or she could have gone underground for a while and then eventually, you know, put the armor back on, I guess. But,
or Morgan's kept them there the entire time.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe.
Crazy, man. Well, that's how we're going to end our bounty section, is with a cool character like that. I think he's cool. Whatever he ends up being, or she, it's a cool new character that's got everyone asking and speculating. So
I hope there's something guys. There. I hope there's something there.
Yeah, I hope so too. Let's move into our feedback. Finally, I know we've got a lot of people waiting to get their thoughts in on the show. We got a lot of feedback for the first two episodes. Let's get into it.
The Republic couldn't have asked for better soldiers, nor I a better friend.
All right, we're going to kick it off with a pair of voicemails from X-Force 11, because I think he wasn't sure if we were doing one big episode, so he sent two voicemails back to back, one for each episode. Here's the first one.
Well, hello, Star Wars fans. It's Jeff, X-Force 11, leaving my feedback about Ahsoka Chapter 1, Master and Apprentice. It was really cool to be back in the Star Wars world and see these characters that we have grown to love on the animated screen come to life in live action. And I will say I'm very pleased about the casting so far, and it's going to be neat to see them live into the characters that we have grown to love through the animated series, and also to see the changes and the life that they've gone through. And I really appreciate getting to see Sabine and getting to see how things have gone for her and how hard it is still on her. It's just interesting to see her dealing with everything and to see the relationship there with Ahsoka and the strain there. And even in the midst of it, Ahsoka realizing that mistakes were made and things were done for the right reason, but with bad consequences. I love that line. And so I really appreciated just the beauty of this introduction to our group in live action and still seeing the homage to the animated there with that image on the memorial. And it was just a great introduction to this series. And I just am immediately drawn in and can't wait to see what's next. That's why I'm glad we got episodes 1 and 2 back to back. All right, those are my thoughts. X-Force is out.
Yeah, no, exactly, man. I mean, I think we were talking about the episode 1 and 2. It just didn't feel right to split them up. It felt like one continuous episode. Let's move on to his second voicemail, see what he said next.
Well, hello, Star Wars fans. It's Jeff, X-Force 11, leaving my feedback about Ahsoka, Toil, and Trouble. Again, we get to see some cool lightsaber battles in this episode. We get to see the plan unfolding. And I appreciate that in Andor, we got to see remnants of the Empire still working together. And while that was more about the administration and the non-force users side of things, we get to see so much more here on this half with the force users. And I'm just generally intrigued about this story. I'm excited because it really seems deep, and it is bringing in something as far as force use and some things that we've kind of been missing, but does it in a new and different way. And I just really appreciate it a whole lot. I appreciate Filoni and all he's doing in writing this and making this feel cinematic and movie-like and making it feel a part of the world while tying so much back to Clone Wars and Rebels. All right, those are my thoughts. X-Force is out.
Exactly. That's what is so cool about Ahsoka being here. It's just bringing everything we loved about Rebels to life.
Mm-hmm.
I think you worded it perfect. Yep, man. Thanks, X-Force. Thanks for being here with us. Next up is somebody new, Vizsla. An email from Ben. What's he have to say?
Yeah, Ben says, hey guys, my name is Ben. I've been listening to the podcast since the first season of The Mandalorian. Just wanted to say I love the podcast. You guys do a great job in your reviews and analysis of these shows. I'm actually a member of the Imperial Outlanders Star Wars costuming group and shared the podcast with some of our members.
Cool.
These two episodes of Ahsoka were great. 10 out of 10, the action, story, visuals, and music are all so good. I have to agree with most people saying it's a season 5 of Rebels. My favorite scene from episode 1 is Baylan and Shin landing on the ship and just taking everyone out with ease. And Baylan's hallway scene gave definite Vader vibes.
Yep.
Favorite scene from episode 2 would have to be the end scene where it was shot for shot the same scene from Rebels with the mural. Definitely excited for the next episodes and to listen to the podcast. Keep up the good work. This is the way.
Well, thanks, Ben. And we got to get you a Star Wars name. Maybe you could just be Obi-Wan. You're already Ben.
Yeah, that's right.
Old Ben. Old hermit out in the desert, right?
Ben Kenobi. Yep.
Yeah. Thanks for chiming in. I love when we hear new listeners or new feedbackers say, hey, I've been listening to you since the beginning. And it's just cool to know that you guys are out there. So,
yes.
Much appreciated, Ben. Much appreciated. Great to have you aboard. Next up is General Grievous.
Hello, gentlemen. It is me, General Grievous from Brisbane, Australia, leaving my feedback for the first two episodes of Ahsoka. Now, I'm going to give these 9 out of 10 millimeters from certain death, because I think that's how far the Inquisitor's lightsaber was from Ahsoka, where she narrowly missed it at the end of the second episode.
Totally.
I was really, really happy with these. Now, I must say that initially, when I first watched them both through, I was a little bit underwhelmed. And I think that Vizsla spoke about this on Inside the Force and summarized it really nicely in that we are used to getting quite big moments in the first episodes of these TV shows, and we didn't really get that. You know, we got stuff that we sort of already knew about. We kind of bit of a recap for anyone who's really into their Star Wars like we all are. So there wasn't a huge payoff of everything, but the second time I watched them and, you know, kind of putting that to the side and just viewing them for what they were, I do think we got two really great episodes to start this series. And I think it started in a really strong way. Visually, absolutely exquisite. I think from the cinematography, from the sets, from the production, and then even just visually how all the characters look, I think they looked absolutely phenomenal. And I was really impressed by the portrayal of all of our Rebels characters. I think they really captured the essence of what those characters were in the originals, in the original series, I should say. And even like Ezra's little cameo, I think it was just perfectly Ezra. Like, it's exactly his mannerisms, exactly how he acts. I thought Sabine's character was extremely well portrayed, and I really am enjoying this sort of dynamic between Sabine and Ahsoka, this kind of unspoken angst or tension between them, which I think we're going to uncover more and more as the season goes on. And I'm sure you boys are going to touch on this, but man, when Sabine put the armor back on, back with the short haircut, lightsaber on her waist, you know, seeing her in action in full Mandalorian armor with a lightsaber, that is going to be absolutely incredible. And yeah, I just thought it was a wonderful start to the series. I did think the music was really interesting in times. Like, I thought that there was a few funny moments where there's sort of this piano that kind of felt a little bit out of place. So would love to hear you guys' thoughts on that. But overall, you know, 9 out of 10 for them both combined. I think we are off to a flyer, and I can't wait for the rest of this series. So boys, let's buckle in. Let's get ready for a big one. Can't wait to hear what the other feedbackers have to say. And I'm really excited for this series. That's General Grievous, over and out.
Awesome to hear your voice again, Grievous, all the way from Brisbane, Australia. It's so cool. I love our show being global. That's
just yes.
Cool. But he brought something up I totally forgot. I even had it in my notes here, and I forgot to add it to, is Sabine's armor. It's not exactly the same as it was in Rebels. The paint job is different.
Yeah, she was always changing it out.
She was always, so you just think it was just a change?
Oh,
so I thought
yeah.
We might have gotten a dead-on replica from Rebels so that we instantly recognized it. But because it didn't have the Rebels symbol in the front of the chest like hers does, and the shoulder pads were both completely different than what we've known her to have. So,
well, I had the new Rebel logo on there. Yeah, the official Rebellion.
Okay. Logo, I mean, it's still cool. Sabine in her colorful armor and her helmet. I mean, oh man, like
No, she looked like Sabine. Lights. She looked like she did at the end of the show.
Yeah. Yeah, and the mural awesome. Too, like that. People were mentioning that a couple times, the bringing that Rebels scene to life.
Yes.
Really, really cool. Yeah.
Yeah.
And what was he saying about the music? He said there was an odd thing in the music at the end there. I just remember loving the music. I didn't pick up on anything being...
Yeah. I mean, it's a different style for sure. It felt...
Yeah.
It felt Star Wars, but it felt new. I mean, we kind of mentioned that. It's definitely...
I think what surprised me is how dark the music sounded for Ahsoka. Ahsoka is supposed to be our savior, our character that's going to bring everything back around, and yet the music and the feeling of everything was so foreboding and dark and like, damn, we're in for trouble. Yeah. Cool, man. Cool, Grievous. Great to hear from you. Next up is Froda, and he says, hello, everyone. Too much at work and not at home nowadays, so I'm going to be short. This was a great start. I really enjoyed the first two episodes of Ahsoka. If someone forgets to mention, the music is absolutely brilliant and the casting is perfect. Looking forward to hearing your thoughts on these episodes. May the Force be with you, Froda in Norway. All right. Here we are, global. Norway, New Zealand. X-Force is in... Where is he? One of the Carolinas?
He's in the States, yeah.
I think, yeah, he's not too far from you, so yeah, there's we're bouncing around. Next up is a voicemail from Parashand, and she warned me in her email, this is a long one. She said, I'm sorry, guys, this one's long, so I have no idea how long. We'll see how she goes here. Here's Parashand.
Well, hello, boys. It's been a long time, and we finally have our first two episodes of Ahsoka. I've been trying to find how I was going to send my feedback, so it's going to be kind of, all over the place. But first of all, I enjoyed the episodes so much. I've probably watched both of them maybe 3 or 4 times each. And I've watched a few other YouTubers' reactions, because sometimes, you know, you get some other things that you might have missed. So, yeah, I've probably seen, you know, certain big scenes probably more than 10 times now. But that said, it was so good to see Rosario back as Ahsoka. I still think that we have a more serious and stoic Ahsoka. There was one little moment where she kind of smiled a little bit when she was figuring out the puzzle at the beginning of the first episode to get the map. But other than that, we didn't really get a lot of, I guess, a happy Ahsoka. So I'm hoping, as, you know, things move on through the episodes, and now that, you know, Sabine is back with her, maybe Ahsoka will lighten up a little bit. I'm not sure. I want to get it out of the way as soon as possible. The New Republic captain of the prison ship, I think Captain Hyland or something like that, he got sabered higher up, more vital organs, so yeah, he's not coming back. And when you compare that to how Sabine got stabbed, hers was more lower abdomen off to the side. It could have been part of her liver, her intestines. I was nerdy. I looked up female anatomy. So, nothing that couldn't have been fixed there. So, her saber to the gut, off to the side a little bit, totally plausible. I'm just really tired of all of the people, you know, spouting off negativity about, you know, nobody dies from a saber, you know, to the gut anymore, and, you know, Qui-Gon was, you know, killed for nothing, blah, blah, blah. I'm just tired. You know, just live with it, ignore it. It's the powers that be are not going to change it for you. If they do it, they do it for them. They're not going to do it because fans are ticked off. So that's all I'm going to say about it ever again. I'm not even going to mention it if it happens again. Morgan Elizabeth. I don't remember if she was actually, if we actually knew that she was a Night Sister in that episode of, The Mandalorian. I don't know. So when we got the actual confirmation that, you know, from herself that she's a Night Sister and she's a survivor, so it makes me wonder if she maybe was one of the very few Night Sisters who survived Dooku's attack on Dathomir. So that's something. The cameos that we got for Ryder, Azadi, and Jaikel were nice little shout-outs to Rebels. And the fact that we got Clancy Brown to play the live-action Ryder was also great. I loved it. I also tried to look up the music for when Sabine, you know, split from that ceremony thing. And, you know, she's on her speeder bike going down that highway to nowhere. And that rock music is playing. I did find who did it. Her name is Sarah Tudson. She's from an indie rock group. I can't remember the name off the hand because I forgot to write that down. But the song is called Giga Ka. It's I-G-Y-A and then K-A-H. I don't know what language that's in. I couldn't find anything to where it would isolate it enough so you could understand the lyrics. But if I had to make a wild guess, it just seems like a lot of the stuff is Huttese. So my headcanon is that's going to be Huttese, and maybe eventually they will release it for the soundtrack. Oh, the ship that was mentioned a couple times by name, Home One. We did see it again in the first episode. This is the same ship that Ackbar commanded in Return of the Jedi. So there's carryover from that. That meeting room on Home One, with kind of like the circular area and the seats, that's the same area where they had the meeting to plan the attack on the second Death Star. So yeah, another nice little carryover bit. I couldn't see also another kind of like Easter egg in one of the shots on Home One in the docking bay area. Supposedly was the ghost, but everything I saw was very blurry, so I'll take people's word for it, but you know, until I actually see it, I don't think it really counts. Those who still think that maybe Sabine has some kind of force sensitivity, I think they pretty much cleared that up here. That's a no, and I'm totally fine with that. Her being Ahsoka's apprentice doesn't have to be just about the Force. You know, there are other aspects of, you know, training and both physical and mental that Sabine could benefit from, I would guess. So I don't have an issue with that. As far as I know, there's a lot of discourse about the reveal that there is another galaxy and that the Purgles took Thrawn and Ezra there back in the finale of Rebels. I mean, I don't see why not. In our own existence, we have more than one galaxy. So I don't see why this is, you know, something to be up in arms and upset about. This is why Morgan Elsbeth is creating this super hyperspace ring so she can travel between the galaxies easier, I would assume. Because I would think that if you were to do this with a regular ship with, you know, their single one, you know, hyperspace engine, it would take forever. So it's my guess that she's been working behind the scenes, you know, to get these, you know, bigger hyperspace engines from old Star Destroyers to help complete her Eye of Sion ship. And I did see somewhere, I can't remember where exactly, that Sion was a Sith Lord from Knights of the Old Republic, so I guess that's kind of a semi tie-in. Yeah, I don't know, just I see weird things after, you know, I watch episodes and go looking for info. And oh, the Loth Cats, I don't remember them being quite as pale white and like brown spotty. I thought they were more, you know, brown and black spotty. But whatever. I still want one. I want one so bad. Yeah. So, that said, the characters of Baylan Skoll and Shin Hati, I did see on, I think it's New Rock Stars on YouTube, that in Norse mythology, there are two wolves called Skoll and Hati that chase after, I think it's the sun and the moon. So that's kind of interesting where they pulled those names from, if that's the case. Very interesting. Shin Hati, she's very, I don't know, I guess just kind of grr, you know, in your face, like, she's just, I don't know, I can't explain it. It's weird. I mean, I don't hate it or anything. It's just I can't explain how she comes across to me. And as far as Balin's skull, the fact that we know he knew Anakin during the Clone Wars. So, you know, he does not seem quite so far gone, I guess you could say, towards the dark side. You know, his comment to Morgan Eldbeth about, you know, if they have to kill Ahsoka, it's a shame because, you know, there are so few Jedi left. So I don't think he's quite far gone. He could come back or could sacrifice himself for one. I don't know. It's a possibility, of course. But that said, it was a great start. I missed lightsabers, I will say. I missed them a lot. And, you know, here's hoping we get, you know, maybe at least name drops for Kallus, Zeb. It would be a shame if we didn't see him since we saw him in the last season of Mandalorian. You know, even if it's over like a video comm or something, I would like to see that. And of course, I'd be curious to see if we would ever get to see Jason Syndulla as well. I mean, he has to be around somewhere. Unless he's at some kind of academy, because I think this is, what, 7 years after that? Or is it 9? I can't remember. But he might be old enough to be going to school or, you know, a training academy of some type. But it'd be interesting to see, nonetheless. And also, since we are getting Mon Mothma, so far, all we know is it'll be like a hologram video. I do wonder if they would finagle somehow getting us Leia, you know, because she is around at that time. Of course, there's always the possibility of Luke showing up again for, you know, maybe some input. I don't know. Honestly, I can't think of a reason why, but it's possible. excuse me. But that's pretty much, I think, all I can think of off the top of my head. I'm really looking forward to next week. And I really like that it's on a different day. That kind of changes things up and, you know, gives more time to let things sink in and rewatch and things like that. And also, I think, I know. The two planets that had the old ruins, the first one where Ahsoka found the map and you saw the Night Sisters carved into the walls, that was not Dathomir, I'm pretty sure. So there were Night Sisters on more than just Dathomir. And then the last planet where Morgan Elsbeth, you know, brought up the map and then the second galaxy, like, showed up, you know, in conjunction with the ruins and stuff like that. And she said that was some ancient race. She didn't say, you know, ancient Nicesters. She said ancient race. And there's lots of talk going around on the internet that those are the ones who were from one of the video games, the KOTAR video games, the ones that look kind of like the hammerhead shark. You know, they get like a conical head and their eyes are on the side, and they get like shark teeth kind of looking, I think. I can't remember what they're called. But people are thinking that they are the race, maybe, that created those ruins on that last planet at the end of episode 2. So yeah, there's a lot of crazy theories and thoughts out there, so beware. You might go down a rabbit hole. But, yeah. I rambled a lot. I hope this makes some sense. And I will see you guys next week. My rating for these two episodes is going to be 8.5 really cute loft cats. So, till next week, everybody take care. Parishan out.
Did you remember everything she said?
I mean, it's a lot of what we talked about, yeah.
That was definitely a record for sure, I would think, Parishan, but yeah, she's always got some interesting ideas and theories. She does a lot of research in checking out her responses before she sends to us, so that's always appreciative for sure. Good stuff. Glad to hear you are enjoying the show and finding all these cool little connections, because, yeah, good stuff, good stuff. Next up, we got to move along, guys, so we can get through all this. We got Jin Costana. All of our old feedbackers are coming back. I think people are excited for Ahsoka. Here's Jin.
Hello, this is Jin Costana calling from New Zealand. Oh, it is good to be back. I hope you guys have been well and been having a good summer. Well, let's get into it. The early scene with our new baddie, Balin, coming down the white corridor with his saber. Obviously a very intentional callback to A New Hope, and I imagine Filoni had a lot of fun planning that one out. It was a fun way to start it off. Yeah, my first feelings are just so awesome to see the characters from Rebels again. Seeing them brought to life is just really cool, and I loved seeing Lothal, the way that they visualized it. It's really very beautiful. And yeah, that high wave is so iconic in Rebels. You know, the Rebel crew was constantly traveling up and down there. It features in so many of the episodes. And so having that chase scene with Sabine along the highway was so much fun. I especially enjoyed how Sabine has been brought to life. I just love the way that the actor Natasha Lou Bordizzo is playing her. In Rebels, Sabine, for me, always felt just a little bit too awesome at everything to be real. but here she's very flawed and very human. And, yeah, so much more relatable to me. So far, she's my favourite character that I've seen in the show. Start off with so many cool revelations. Ahsoka has been training Sabine to be Jedi. I did not see that coming at all. I think that's just such a clever way to frame the story. Giving Ahsoka and Sabine this history and tension, which brings out all their insecurities and fears. You know, we got to see Sabine still hurting deeply over Ezra, you know, carrying this guilt that she couldn't save him, as well as, you know, the pain that he chose to sacrifice himself and leave her. And we also see that she felt abandoned and unwanted by Ahsoka. You know, so we see her doubting her worth and feeling that she's not good enough. And then for Ahsoka is bringing out these fears that she wasn't good enough as a master, you know, echoing Kanan's fears about Ezra that he always had. Oh, there's just so much bubbling under the surface between these two already. And all of this puts the relationship between Ahsoka and Sabine at the heart of the show. I just love that. You know, the master Padawan chemistry is by far my favourite dynamic in Star Wars. And I'm so glad for Ahsoka as well that she gets to complete the circle of her Jedi journey, you know, from being a Padawan and now being able to be a master as well. It's a really fun choice to make Hu Young Ahsoka's sidekick. I always enjoyed the Clone Wars episodes that had him in it. The interaction between Sabine and Hu Young in the hospital was really funny, but yeah, also really necessary for Sabine. Unsurprisingly, she was not reassured by hearing she's the least force-attuned Padawan ever, but Hu Young was able to get through to her and show her that this path is a choice that she can make. It's not about Ahsoka or anyone else, it's about her. So he empowers her to take control of her own destiny, which is really awesome. I love that they brought Morgan Elspeth back as the antagonist. The scenes between her and Ahsoka in The Mandalorian were epic, And the revelation that she's a Night Sister is so cool as well. You know, it really ties her deeper into Ahsoka and Anakin's history. You know, they had this complicated relationship with Ventress. And, yeah, the way that the Night Sisters interacted with the Force was always really fascinating as well. So it's cool that we get to see that explored in live action. Hera is just so great too. You know, she was the emotional centre of the Rebel crew. I've always loved her for the compassionate way that she listens and understands everyone. You know, she has this incredible emotional insight. And here we see how necessary she is to Ahsoka and Sabine's relationship. You know, they both have this tendency to close down and go it alone. You know, that's how they coped with many difficulties in the past. You know, but they really need each other. And it's Hera who will keep guiding them back together. Yeah, this new duo, I'm not sure we can call them Seth, the orange-red blades. Yeah, there's so much potential in their story. I found it interesting at the end there that Baylan was expressing a reluctance to kill Ahsoka. You know, they're obviously not like Inquisitors at all, who had no qualms whatsoever. Basically, they seem like Force-trained bounty hunters. You know, he has respect for Force users, you know, perhaps even particularly for the few Jedi-trained ones that are left. So obviously that's like a callback to him being trained at the temple. His Padawan, Shinhati, yeah, she was looking at him constantly, you know, when they're interacting with Elspeth to gaze his reactions. She doesn't appear to trust Elspeth herself. And she also, Hattie, doesn't understand the wider plan around Thrawn either. You know, for now, she looks really loyal to her master. But we'll see whether, you know, her uncertainty changes into a questioning of the path that she's on as the series plays out. And the whole sequence in the shipyard building, it was building on what has been revealed, you know, in The Mandalorian, that the Empire and its loyalists never really went away. I'm so interested to see how they're going to bring Thrawn into this and what his intentions are going to be. You know, the Thrawn book trilogies are so fantastic. I really enjoyed them. And, you know, in that it showed that he only joined the Empire to see if they were going to be strong enough allies, you know, to fight the far stronger enemy that his people were dealing with in the unknown regions. You know, so will he still be interested in the Empire since they've fallen? You know, will he think it's worth trying to rebuild it because he thinks it could be strong enough to face the Grisks, which was his enemy? You know, has he learned anything in the new galaxy that will change his perspective or aims? Yeah, there's just so many questions. Thrawn's my favourite antagonist because he's not really bad at all. You know, it's shown so well in the books. You know, he's incredibly loyal to his own people, and he's just doing whatever is necessary to reach his goals. You know, he's just a very logical person who follows out the most logical way to reach his goals, and he doesn't bother him if people have to be sacrificed, but he doesn't sacrifice people for no reason. He doesn't just go murder people in a rage like Vader does. You know, so his character in the books is so fascinating. I hope they stay true to that. You know, Elspeth certainly believes that he is the saviour, but will he even want to be found? You know, I can't wait to see how it all unravels. You know, and Ezra too, we just see a little glimpse of him in the hologram. You know, I hope he's found by the end of the series. I'd so love to see him reunited with the Rebel crew. And, you know, in the second season of Ahsoka, which I hope is made, you know, face the fallout from this season together. You know, he grew up so much at the end of Rebels. He really changed from a boy to a man. So, yeah, I want to know how the past years of exile in a new galaxy changed him. And I hope we get to find out. Well, that's my thoughts for today. Look forward to hearing yours, and bye for now. Bye from New Zealand.
Yes, good to hear from you too, Jen. She brought up something about the books, and I forgot to mention at the top of the show, I've been listening to the original Thrawn trilogy, the Heir to the Empire trilogy.
Right.
I'm halfway through book two right now. And I understand why people wished that was the next trilogy of movies, because you listen to it, and Mark Thompson, they just re-released a brand new version of it with Mark Thompson doing all the narration, and he is so good at the voices. He nails Luke, Han, Leia, Chewie, he gets every character close enough that you feel like it's them when you're listening to these stories. And because of that, these books, it's just like revisiting the original trilogy. It's just a few years have passed and you're continuing on with these characters from the original trilogy. And I wish they had done that. I get it.
Yeah.
It's good.
Yeah, it's very good. I'm actually in the middle of... I just started the Thrawn Ascendancy trilogy.
Oh, okay.
So
what's the timeline on that one? Is that replacing Heir to the Empire to be canon?
No. No? This is before... So after what you read, or what you're in the middle of, you know, Timothy Zahn wrote a Thrawn trilogy that is canon, that takes place during, like, right before Rebels and during Rebels. Mm-hmm. And then this is a prequel to that. So this is kind of around the Clone Wars era.
So there's three Thrawn trilogy stories out there right now?
Yeah, two of them are canon, and the one you're reading is not.
Is not. So I'm starting with the one that was written first, but no longer canon.
Okay. Correct.
Huh. Yeah, yeah. Because, I mean, in this one, they're talking about Mara Jade and you know, Leia's pregnant with twins. So there's a lot of stuff that's different than what we saw. And I think the sequel movies kind of pigeonholed a lot of the stories to not be able to be brought into canon because, you know, for instance, Leia and Han only have one kid and that was it. So it changes a lot of things.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah. Yeah, cool stuff, Jin. We're going to keep moving along. We got two more. Next up is Alisa Tano talking about her own show. Let's see what she had to say.
Hey, guys. It is Alisa Tano sending in feedback for Ahsoka. Something I honestly never thought I'd say, and I'm thrilled that I get to say it. This, I've been waiting and waiting for this, and it absolutely delivered. I loved it. I loved every second of it. It just felt really good to watch it, if that makes sense. Like, it just felt like it should. I loved that it picked up kind of right where it left off, and it threw us right into the new story. The characters are perfection. The casting's amazing. The only thing in the whole episode that I've been kind of chewing on, she's not quite right for me somehow. And I really hope she grows on me really quickly because Hera is just I think she's probably my favorite character from Rebels. I love Captain Hera, and now she's like up in the ranks, and I feel like there's a lot of really, really, really big things coming for her and for everyone in the whole show. Like, that's kind of the feeling that the first two episodes gave me, is that something really big is coming. Other than that, I'm just, like I said, thrilled about this whole show existing, and I can't wait to hear your podcast and the deep dive that you guys are going to do into everything. I loved all the little throwbacks and connections to the past. At the same time, they were like dropping stuff for us to be looking forward in the story. So it's kind of this cool swirl of both past and present and future in the two episodes. And I can't wait. I cannot wait. Anyways, looking forward to the podcast. And that's all I had to say.
Just a little bit of excitement there, hey?
Yeah, lots. Yeah. Nice.
Yeah, she loved Ahsoka so much from Clone Wars and stuff. So yeah, to bring that character to life, it's pretty something special.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
But see, she said something was off about Hera too. So I wonder if we were picking up on the same kind of feeling. Mm. I don't know. We'll see. We got lots to go. I think she'll be fine.
Right.
Last up is someone who has been listening to the show, but has never sent in feedback. He is a friend, Carrie Johnson, who is a huge contributor to my Tomorrow's Legends podcast, but I know he loves Star Wars too, and finally, he's sending in some feedback for us. Here you are, Carrie, to wrap it up. We got to get you a Star Wars name too. Maybe he tells it in his feedback. We'll see.
Greetings, citizens of Mandalore. This is Carrie Johnson here, a.k.a. Perry White, and since this is a Star Wars show, I'm giving myself the nickname of Core Genzo, and I'm here to give feedback for Ahsoka's episodes 1 and 2. And wow, what an incredible feeling to be able to say, I'm able to give feedback for the first two episodes of live-action Ahsoka. What a world we freaking live in. All right, so let's start with what I absolutely loved about the episode, or just about the show in general. I absolutely love the voice work that Ashley Eckstein has done for the character of Ahsoka. And who knows, maybe 5 years down the line or something along those lines, I would absolutely love if someone were to dub over Rosario Dawson's voice and interject Ashley Eckstein's voice into the show. That would be fantastic. But I will say this, I really love the sort of life that Rosario Dawson brings to the character, the wisdom that you can see, and also sort of balance with the sass that's always sort of been there with the character of Ahsoka. And I just like the way that she's able to combine the two. And I really love her performance. But absolutely, positively, the standout star for me has been the character of Sabine. And that even goes back to the animated show. I sort of always thought that she had a much more compelling story to tell, and it would not have hurt my feelings one bit if the story of Rebels was told entirely from her perspective. That's just how incredible I think her story is. And seeing Natasha Liu Bordizzo bring that character to life, the rebel in her and the sass that she has and the stubbornness, man, she just brings it all to the screen. And I just really love the take that she has on the character, and I can't wait to see more of it. What else did I love or really like about the episode? Other than obviously the big mystery that we have out here in terms of where is Grand Admiral Thrawn and will we see much of him in this series, as well as Ezra, I like the other mysteries that were presented in the first two episodes of the show, such as, I mean, who is Baylan Skoll, or more importantly, who was Baylan Skoll? Obviously, we know from the trailers that he knew and knows a lot of the Jedi that unfortunately have fallen. And we get that little moment at the end of episode two where he sort of lamented the fact that he would have to kill another Jedi, or at least a Jedi, when there are so few left. You could just tell in his performance that there's just more there, and I can't wait to see more of it. I also love the mystery of who Shin Hati is, and absolutely, she is a freaking hottie. But I'm just really interested to know what her motivations are and what her backstory is. Is she just a Padawan who sort of is along for the ride, or does she have her sort of own ambitions and goals and plans and purposes? And I really can't wait to see more of that character get fleshed out as well. And so I've told you what I loved about the episode, and I told you what I liked about the episode. And quite honestly, I could probably take up about 20 minutes of telling you all the things that I really loved and liked about the episode. But I sort of also want to talk about the things that I think may be issues for the show. And issues might not be the right word, but I couldn't think of a better one. And I think obviously the show will have to whatever degree, fill in the audience and have Ahsoka tell the story of where exactly she was during the Galactic War. I mean, during the entire time of the trilogy, we need to know where she was and what she was doing. It obviously feels and sounds like she was doing a lot of ground level rebel things, but it just would be really nice if the show gave us an opportunity to see what that looked like.
Yes.
And quite honestly, I think another thing that the show is going to have to deal with, and I'm not one of those people when you sort of introduce or you know that a character is part of a continuity or if it's part of the universe, that you always have to bring them in. But I think the really big question for this show is going to be, well, if Ahsoka is trying to take down this significant threat that is Grand Admiral Thrawn, the legitimate question would have to be, does she call in Luke Skywalker to sort of help in that endeavor? And I'm not saying that she does. I just think that the fact that we know he's there and she knows him, I mean, it would just seem quite odd that there isn't some sort of explanation for either why she tried to reach out to him or why she didn't. Obviously, we know that Luke is running his school and she may feel that that is a more important focus for him at the moment, but it just seems hard to believe that something as significant as the threat of Thrawn would not call Ahsoka to call in all of the resources that she has available, and Luke would be a significant one. So we'll see, obviously, yeah, if there is any sort of name drop or if there is any sort of inclusion of a Luke Skywalker character in this show. It'll be interesting to see. All right. Mm-hmm. So let me get to maybe what I did not like so much about the first two episodes. And I know that the first two episodes, there is a lot of establishing that has to be done, which is fine, which is fantastic, particularly for people who, even for people who are familiar with the Clone Wars and are familiar with Rebels, it's still important to sort of establish the baseline of where we are and the continuity and those sorts of things. But I will say that there were a number of scenes that were really just sort of slow. And I feel like with better editing, they may have been able to work around this sort of plotting nature of some of those scenes, particularly the one when Ahsoka was going to get the map. But that just felt, and I know that there were some Indiana Jones elements to all that, which is fine and which is fantastic. I just thought that it was a little bit slow. Who knows? That's just my opinion. But even based on all that, I give the first two episodes together a combined 9 out of 10. I did prefer the second episode to the first one, but that's just sort of a personal feeling. I also have a thought of, and it just seems sort of strange that we've had so many people survive lightsaber stabs and cuts and that sort of thing. I mean, Darth Maul was basically bisected by a lightsaber. At the end of the first episode here, we have Sabine, who was basically impaled by a lightsaber. And we've basically had a couple of other people who have had what appear to be mortal wounds from lightsaber, and they survived, which makes me think back to Qui-Gon Jinn and, maybe if Obi-Wan had gotten him to a med bay, perhaps maybe he would have survived. And I don't know that we ever did really see Han Solo's body, so maybe somewhere in the new trilogy that they're going to make, maybe Han Solo is still alive. I just remember a time when basically a lightsaber strike was pretty, pretty fatal, unless, you know, it was just an arm or a leg or a hand. But it seems like nowadays you can pretty much survive those things depending on what the intent of the writers and the directors and the producers are. Anyway, I just thought that was pretty interesting, and when you think about it in the grand scheme of things, pretty funny. But like I said, I really enjoyed the episode. Yep. I am looking forward to what others have to say about it. And since this is my very first time offering feedback to the Mandalore podcast, I hope you guys welcome me to the family, and I look forward to learning a great deal from you guys. Anyway, this has been Core Genzo meeting a deadline. I guess if they have deadlines in a time long ago in a galaxy far, far away, but I'm willing to bet that they did. Anyway, I'm out.
He's a journalist in real life, so he's always got the tagline about meeting his deadline. So
nice.
Awesome. You are, of course, very welcome to the show and to the family, Carrie. I've known you for many years now, so thanks for hopping on board the Razor Crest with us here and start talking Star Wars. Great to hear. I mean, we got no Legends shows, so yeah, I'm glad that you decided to hop on over here. Core Genzo. You got to send me the spelling of that so that I've got it right in the notes. Because right now I just have his carry. But now that we know you're going to go as Core Genzo, you got to tell us how to spell it, and you got to tell us the background of that name, what it means, and where you got it from.
Yeah. Cordova is the only name I can think that's close to it. That's from Jedi Fallen Order also.
Oh, okay.
There you Master go. Cordova. Yeah,
maybe he plays the games. I don't know.
Maybe.
Yeah. Good stuff. He's always good for excellent feedback. Well written. I mean, he writes for a living, so he's good with his thoughts there. And he had a couple funny points there. You know, with the questions that we also had during the show, and we just don't have answers to, and we're just kind of chuckling, like,
yeah,
how and why, and you know, maybe they'll explain it. Who knows?
We'll get there.
We'll get there.
Yeah.
Yeah. We'll get there. But we don't have any answers for you right now, man, but we'll maybe see what happens. We'll see what comes. But this has been a long one, guys. We got to wrap the show up. We are pushing 4 hours. This is insane. Of a premiere episode, and we're pulling 4 hours. So, whew. I know Vizzle's got to get to sleep here. I got to get editing after this, so it's going to be a long night. But we appreciate all your feedback, guys. Totally, totally do. We love it. We love it so much. If you guys want to be part of the show and join the show, if you want to be, you know, on the show like these great feedbackers, listen to this. It gives you all the instructions from us, the masters, to you, the Padawans.
If you'd like to be a part of the show, you can send in feedback to the Mandalore Podcast at gmail.com. And also join our Facebook group. Otherwise, if you don't, we'll put a bounty on your head.
And there we go with the Mandalore music. You know, I've been contemplating this. Tell me if you like the idea or not. The ending theme song for Ahsoka as the credits are rolling. Should we swap that music in for our closing credit music here?
Yeah, we could. Yeah, I don't think that would hurt. If it works.
I have to see what it sounds like. I mean, this is traditional. You hear this music, you know it's our show.
Correct. So. Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe I'll find a way to mix it in somehow, because it's such a cool song. That ending credits with the map being drawn out. Whatever that song is, it's really cool.
Yes. It's really good.
Yeah. Cool, guys. Well, this is going to be out. I mean, it's Monday morning, super early Monday morning right now. This will be released Monday during the day, and you already have less than 24 hours to wait until Tuesday.
Tuesday night, that's right.
Yeah, episode 3 comes out already, so that's how it's kind of going to be, because we like to record The Mandalore on Sunday nights, and it's not our fault they decided to air it Tuesday, so you guys got to wait almost a week to hear our thoughts right before the next episode.
Yeah. I mean, technically, it's not coming out that much earlier, because it comes out at midnight.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
Usually, it came out at midnight on Tuesdays on the West Coast.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it's, not too much so it's coming out 6 hours before, really. But people aren't watching that much in the middle of the night.
Cool. Yeah, well, check out Vizla's other show, Inside the Force. He's already discussed Ahsoka with his co-host Han over there. I got to check it out and see what you guys had to say. If we rehashed anything too much here, we'll have to see. But yeah, check that out. Check out Tomorrow's Legends, guys. We are rewatching season 3 right now. And I'm trying to remember if it was as good as it, we thought it was back then, or as bad. I don't know. We're looking into that. That's what we're checking out. So that is it from us. This is Cyber N, and we have spoken.
It's D. Vizsla. This is the way.
The Mandalore is not affiliated with Disney, Lucasfilm, or Fairview Entertainment. This is a fan-made podcast for entertainment purposes only. All music and sound effects are solely owned by their respective properties. Be sure to check out our partner shows, Tomorrow's Legends and Dive into DC, covering your favorite superhero and DC comic stories.